think all the films around us, Stephen and that, I find weird, really. As comfortable as it can be. I don't enjoy it at all. But I think it's important because of how Stephen was killed and also the way in which we were treated as a family. My son's been murdered and none of these officers, the justice system, the politicians, nobody cared. These idiots who have murdered my son had more rights than we did.
Second camera.
And I'm not doing any filming with you. So it's better be a good one. Also, just to talk about Stephen a bit more. And so people can see that he had a life, not just in death, but before.
Sorry, if you just... just so we've got these cutaway shots.
Yeah. Dorian and Neville, they were just very good, honest people.
Can I just get you to turn a page, please?
Stephen, he was a very ordinary kid. And he had this disarmingly big grin. Our peers were black and white. So race was very much something that we were aware of, but it was more something that our parents had fought the good fight to make it less of an issue for us. We were just at a bus stop in London. We were attacked at a bus stop in one of the greatest cities in the world.
People seem to think I may have moved on and I've got over Stephen's death. I haven't. I don't think I have come through the other end. All I wanted to do is to get justice for Stephen. Growing up in the Caribbean, a lot of people have a pet name that they called. My family would call me Joy, and I didn't know my name was Dorian until I went to school.
Since the early 1950s, coloured immigrants from the Commonwealth have come in much greater numbers. They've come in search of better jobs and a better life for their families.
I understand my mother left when I was about two, her husband-to-be sent for her.
20-odd years ago, it was quite rare to see a Negro.
But you see, when I came in 49, there weren't so many coloured people. Your eyes were geared to looking for a coloured face in the street. The only ones we used to see then were Sikhs. I think that's how you pronounce it.
They create an atmosphere of foreignness.
I never met my mum until I was nine. After my grandmother died, that's when I came here. And I arrived, and I just remember seeing the houses, how close together they were. That was strange. And you see these strangers, because I've never met any of them. So was my mother and my stepbrother. And when I got here, I had a baby brother. My other siblings were born after that. By the time I got to secondary school, there was quite a large mix of black girls. Most of my friends were black, but I didn't look at it as I'm black and they are white.
In the early days, people from the West Indies was invited to go to England to go and help to rebuild the country after the war. But then found out there was lots of discrimination against people from the West Indies, black people. I found myself working as a tailor. And while I was working in the tailoring trade, I met Doreen's mother, who was also a dressmaker. And while I was doing that, I eventually met Doreen. I kind of liked her.
We used to travel together on the train. That sort of developed from there.
You can get it if you really want.
And then at lunchtime, I'd leave work because I used to work in Moorgate and go and meet him over at Edgware Road, I think it was. Which was quite a distance to go for, meet somebody for lunch.
You succeed at last. I saw her the first time I even think about getting married to somebody.
Looking back on it, I got married 2 weeks after my 20th birthday. Looking back on it now, how would you get married so young? But at the time, in the 70s, that's what happened.
Joy, that's her pet name. She looked beautiful in the photograph.
I never looked like one of those guys from the Four Tops. And Neville was very tall. And then when Stephen came along, life was fine. Stephen was born 2 years later, and that was a fantastic time. You succeed at last. I remember spending so much time teaching him to say mum first. We would do so much stuff together, play together, read, do everything. And his first words was mum. But then he began to call me dad.
Little mum.
Nursery, he loved nursery, and school. Stephen got out of school really well. He was just one of these kids who would just strive at everything. But I was a very strict mum. And he used to say to me, mum, you care too much.
In the days when I lived next door to Doreen, I just remember that it was really nice to meet a nice family that, you know, had got children the same ages as ours. They all used to play together. We used to do lots and lots of things together.
We all grew up together. So we've never had a thing that, oh, you must be careful because you're black, this could happen to you.
Stephen didn't experience the sense of difference growing up that I experienced. My parents were very political. And, you know, being of mixed heritage, I was made to be aware of race and politics and injustice. 13 dead and nothing said. When the Deptford fire happened, that was a monumental impact. A lot of young black teenagers burnt in a fire.
Local black organisations allege racially motivated arson, and they accuse the police of not pursuing their investigations with full vigour. The police deny this.
It felt like it was the tipping point for people's frustration in the system and in our government. It felt like it was the tipping point for people to kind of rise up
against, you know, Thatcherite Britain. We still had those divisive lines.
I grew up in Deptford. I was going to Blackie Bleecoat School. Stephen, who we called Steve, we were in the same class on the first day. He was a cool guy. And everybody loved him. He used to train at Cambridge Harriers. Steve was an excellent athlete.
I just remember him always running. I was very proud, because I think he was very good. Athletics was his thing.
I just remember that London felt quite inclusive, actually. It felt quite positive, felt quite cosmopolitan. Soul to Soul were telling us to keep on moving, and Public Enemy were telling us to fight the power. But leading up to Stephen's death, and then soon after, I think it changed radically.
Put the British people first. Stop immigration, start repatriation.
Much in the same way that Brexit has changed the nation. It brought back these feelings of maybe I'm not part of this community, maybe I'm part of the other, whatever that means.
Extreme right-wing groups like the British National Party are trying to capitalise on the rise in unemployment.
In the areas just outside of London, people resent the fact that immigrants have got jobs and that they haven't got jobs.
Anytime you stepped out the inner city area of London, then you were always, as a black person, under danger and threat in these all-white enclaves that were working-class white suburbs. I was a member of the National Black Caucus at the time. When we came to areas like Eltham, what we saw is a massive escalation of racist attacks of people moved into those areas.
I've been called a nigger every now and again, like walking past the bus stop and someone drove past and shouted out, "Oi, nigger, you should be burnt."
I think it was both ways. you know? Like, black people don't know white people, so white people don't know black people.
Eltham, in those days, people were living in fear, black or Asian people. There were some very, very serious attacks.
This guy called Rodriguez, he was in Eltham Park with a white girl, and that's why he got attacked. And he needed 27 stitches.
Eltham, it felt like the last stronghold of a white community that was holding on to the past, or a perception of the past, some kind of glory days that never existed.
Where I live, Wellong Road, it's not what it used to be.
I think people would probably like to tell you that they left their doors unlocked. You used to hear that kind of conversation.
Your mum used to, in the 30s, in the 40s. But nowadays, you can't. There's so many tea leaves about, which is thieves if you don't know what it is.
I didn't have fond feelings for the place. I didn't feel comfortable there. Thamesmead wasn't that far away, and that felt like a real no-go place to me.
Hey, we're good.
On the 21st of February 1991, Roland Adams, 15-year-old, with his brother Nathan, had gone to Hawksmoor Youth Club. On the way back, confronted by the Goldfish gang, calling them niggers and all that, and stabbed Roland Adams in the neck, and he died at the Boiler House roundabout.
I think Doreen and I got a bit of a shock when the youngsters started to tell us, you know, so-and-so can't go in that area and we can't go in that area, and we just lived in our own little world and didn't really know about these things.
When the economy suffers and goes down, racism always goes up. We decided that we would reach out internationally. Contacted Reverend Al Sharpton.
You came out here because you told the world I was going to be banned. Don't start talking about civilized. But tell us what all the lies that y'all have written.
I remember the front page, I think it was the Daily Mail, which had race hate preacher from hell comes to UK.
I suppose I become more aware of the racist murders when Roland Adams was killed. Even though I used to read to his...
Maureen and I got a bit of a shock when the youngsters started to tell us, you know, so-and-so can't go in that area and we can't go in that area, and we just lived in our own little world and didn't really know about these things.
When the economy suffers and goes down, racism always goes up. We decided that we would reach out internationally. Contacted Reverend Al Sharpton.
You came out here because you told the world I was going to be banned. Don't start talking about civilized, but tell us what all the lies that y'all have written.
I remember the front page, I think it was the Daily Mail, which had race hate preacher from hell comes to UK.
I suppose I become more aware of the racist murders when Roland Adams was killed. Even though I used to read stories in the papers, that was closer to home. Stephen said to me they were having a march when Harold Stockton came over from America, and he's telling me he's going. I said, I don't want you to go, because I was more worried about him. But he still went because he felt that he knew Roland and he wanted to be there to support. But I was worried about him all the time while he was there.
Eltham, 25 years ago, there were people carrying knives around at night around that area without any doubt at all.
Norris, Dobson, the air cords, they were actually targeting people.
I was going, definitely. They wouldn't have no one taking the piss. I definitely wouldn't back down from a fire.
In the months before the murder of Stephen, there'd been another murder just off the roundabout by the kebab house. Rohit, who went to Chislehurst and Sidcup Grammar School, and he was stabbed by a man from the kebab house.
There was a stabbing in a wimpy bar in Eltham, and the air corps were involved with that. So the police knew about these people already.
I think the air corps and Norris, they got away with quite a few stabbings. I think Stacey Benefield was stabbed.
He was lucky, very lucky, I think, Stacey. And then he killed him, just missed his heart. There was a little confrontation, and one of them pulled a knife and stuck it straight in him, as far as I know.
there was a simmering cauldron of unrest around race issues. The Metropolitan Police I inherited in 1993 was underperforming, and I knew that race relations in London were going to be a huge challenge.
Tolerant of racially motivated attacks.
And that's why, when I became commissioner, I chose as my first speech the importance of race and diversity and justice.
As the tools of their political expression.
When Stephen got older and he had a job, I used to say to him, do be careful when you're coming home this late at night.
I was watching people going to work. He saw me looking through the window, and he stopped and said to me, Dad, are you okay? And I said, yes. He said, okay, Dad. And I watched him walk out of the house, down to the turning and turn through the alleyway, and that was the last time I saw him alive.
I went to meet him after school. We then went to his uncle's house. Steve wanted to get home because he hadn't seen his mum all that week. So we took a bus into Eltham, bus stop across the road from McDonald's.
That is your time, trust me.
286 came past us, so I just started running, and then we got on the bus.
Yeah, but Stephen, man, we could all be going out clubbing and all that.
And then we took that bus to the bus stop just before the roundabout.
Complain, you always should complain about something. Man. We get the bus from over there, it's just common sense, it'll be quicker, don't lie.
I was an au pair near Woolwich. I was waiting at the bus stop, so I had time to watch them or to look at them.
Serious thing, though, you know what I mean?
They were chatting and they were joyful and lively, and they were doing dance steps on the pavement, and I felt, wow, they look very cool. And Stephen went to look at the timetable.
122 or 161?
122, man.
How long?
If we'd known that the bus was going to take so long, the 122 to come, we would have just jogged it.
Oh, this is long, man.
Yeah, it's long, man. It's not long, man. Just wait, you're always in some kind of rush, some kind of madness.
So I'm quite agitated about being there at that time of night because, you know, people will drive past and throw things at you, shout abuse.
So what, can you see a bus?
I can't even see it from it. Hang on, it might be one day up to know, you know.
I remember him and I having this discussion about, can you see a bus? And then we both were walking too near the roundabout because we wanted to see if another bus was going to come.
That bus?
I think he's, you know. Yeah, that sounds better. I don't want to go out there and we miss one coming up this way, and you know that, you get me? Is that 122? That's a bus number, is that 122?
I don't even know what number that is.
If straight ahead of me is 12 o'clock where Stephen's standing, then at 10 o'clock I remember this group of white boys on the other side of the road shouting, and then one of them said, what nigger? As he started to run across the road, he was pulling stuff out of his pocket, out of his trousers. And he couldn't run properly, and he just came. The whole group started running, and I shouted to Steve to run. And I just saw this guy strike a downward blow, which I thought was a weapon.
I was watching television, and I heard a scream or a shout, and it was an unusual scream or shout.
No, come on, man! Come on, Steve, man! Come on! I'm telling you, coming back, come on!
Stephen stood up and started to run and leaving his rucksack back. And so I felt, he's okay, it's fine, he's running fast.
But he come back, but I'm sharing you. But they take coming, come on. Come on, Steve. Come on, just keep running.
He wasn't running properly, he was running lopsided, and he kept saying to me, Dwayne, like, what's happened to me? And I just kept saying to him, let's just run.
Just keep running, lad. Come on with me. No, Steve, man. Come on, I'll pick you up. Come on, stay on fire, but come on, man. Come on. No, please. No.
I ran across the road. I saw these two people, and I asked them for their help, and they just walked past me.
Help me.
I tried to stop cars in the road. No cars were stopping.
Please.
I went to the phone box, and I dialed 999.
Ambulance, please, man. Ambulance, I need an ambulance, man.
And I gave the address in the phone box, but the address in the phone box was incorrect.
I don't know the fucking postcode!
I remember that a car pulled up, some people came out. And he said to me, what's happened? I told him that he'd been hit. But at that time, I didn't know that he wasn't here with iron bar, that he'd been stabbed in those places. I didn't know any of that. I'm not defending the police at all. But I think that also confused the police that turned up, because they were expecting to see someone hit with an iron bar.
Is he still breathing there?
It's all right. It's okay.
Ambulance.
Where's the ambulance? Where's the ambulance? Where's the fucking police?
This boy is bleeding very badly.
The police were being unhelpful. Steve was just lying there bleeding to death. I always remember seeing that.
They just ran out and hit him with an iron bar.
Guess what I'm trying to tell you?
Why would they do that, Dwayne?
The ambulance comes, and when they pick him up, they turn him over and pick him up. He is completely soaked in his own blood.
Yeah, if you could just stay out of the way, please. Thank you.
Away, my first I'm going away with my course.
So, how are you?
Right.
Professor?
When I came back, Neville was waiting for me where the coach dropped us off down in Woolwich. So, you know, you ask the question, how's the kids? And how are they doing? Everybody seems to be fine. Stephen's not home.
Well, I did tell him that you were coming home tonight, so.
But that wasn't unusual, so I wasn't worried.
Stuart?
I got dressed in my nightclothes. They went to have something to eat.
Did Stephen say where he was going?
No.
And it's just while we were sitting there watching the news, you heard the door knock. And because I was in my nightclothes, Neville went to answer the door.
You lose your key? It's Lawrence, all right. There's been a bit of a fight.
It was just Stephen's name I heard.
Well, my lad Joe says that you're Stephen, he might have got hurt a bit.
I saw Joey, who lives at the back, and his dad. Joey just said that there's an incident happened down Wellhall Road.
After that, I just saw him lying on the floor. All right. Thanks very much.
Called 999. They don't know anything. So that's when we got in the car and went looking for him.
It's in Wellhall Road, isn't it?
That's as far as we went, Wellhall Road. And I saw no flashing lights, nothing to draw us to that area. So we just thought, well, he's gone to the hospital, so let's go to the hospital, which is what we did. When we got there, I never went to park the car, and I walked in. And I didn't see anybody. Even though Dwayne was there, I didn't even notice him.
Neville.
It's only when Neville came in that Neville noticed him and noticed the police officer.
Okay.
Mr. Lawrence. Stephen's being looked after. Harriet here is going to look after you, and we'll let you know. Yeah?
Okay. So follow me to the family room.
They ushered us into a room, and Dwayne came in, and he just wasn't talking. He wasn't talking.
Somebody who's stealing?
We're going to need to try and get a central line in here.
So we just sat there waiting. You sort of sit there thinking, OK, what am I supposed to do now?
OK, let's call it. Thanks, everyone.
OK, death confirmed 11:17 or 23:17.
Thank you.
The nurse or doctor came in to say that Stephen had died.
What?
No, I can't be right.
That's not true.
It still seems so unreal.
It's something hard when somebody tell you that, because you think you're watching a play or a drama. It's not real. It wasn't real.
I suppose when I looked at him,
he had a cut on his face. But he just looked as if he was sleeping. They had a tape around his neck. The gallon came up to about here. They could still see the tape that they put on his neck. I stayed with him for a while. And then we went back out. And then other families started coming.
We eventually decided to go home because we didn't know what else to do. So we went home. Stuart came downstairs and we told him. But Georgina, we didn't wake her. So the morning she woke up, I didn't sleep at all. And she must have heard, but I don't know what she heard that Neville said on the phone. And she just ran upstairs screaming. So then I had to go out to her. And it's like, how do you hold her?
I spent the whole night in police station. I was consistently questioned about the what nigger. Was that, you sure that wasn't a nickname? You sure you didn't hear wrong? Didn't Steve have other nicknames that other people would have called him by? No. Are you sure you heard that? Yes.
My name's Ian Crampton. I was a detective superintendent and got called out to the scene of Stephen's death. It was a stabbing, I was told, at that time. And the victim had died. On my way, I called at the Plumstead police station where Dwayne was. I learned from Dwayne that it was a stranger attack. He'd seen Stephen being struck and went down on the floor. A stranger attack is always a little more difficult because you haven't got people knowing one another, which in many cases leads to some sort of motive.
Friday.
Mr. Lawrence?
Right.
I'm Detective Sergeant Bevan, and this is my...
We were then introduced to two officers who were supposed to be liaison officers to come and help us.
No, that's all right. You're coming up. My wife is upstairs with the kids and all that.
And then end up with pen and paper taking down the names of my friends and relatives who came to help us.
I'm sorry, who are these people?
Oh,
my name is Marianne Jean-Baptiste, and I played Doreen Lawrence.
Hello.
The film The Murder of Stephen Lawrence followed the family very closely. There is a helplessness in there. That you get up and you keep going. Because we've done it for generations, black women. You just have to keep going.
Stephen Lawrence died, stabbed at a bus stop in Eltham. His father has called for the return of the death penalty.
I think they should bring back hanging. Something like this. It's a senseless murder.
I had to go on TV and do appeal for witnesses. And I was then told that Crampton was only going to do the case until Monday. Why would you want to take over a case for only 2 days?
This was not by choice. At that stage, it needed somebody that was going to be the SIO to be there full time. I had other commitments at court. It was something that there was no way that you could get around.
That's a big one. That is a huge bomb.
The column of smoke rising above the city skyline left Londoners in little doubt about the size of the blast.
A Saturday, there was a major IRA bomb in London, the Bishopsgate bomb, and my focus was preventing London being bombed by terrorists. If I'm honest, that was my primary focus day to day.
So many rumours were flashing about, you know, somebody called somebody a black name and a fight happened. Who knows? I never heard nothing. I just heard a shout or a scream.
Obviously, there was names flying about, and everyone seemed to think it was the same people. But I don't need to be blurting out people's names in here. You know what I mean? You never know what's going to come from that.
On the Saturday morning when I got in, I was made aware that there were phone calls coming in, naming people, but not saying how they knew. Many of the calls were of a similar nature, as if a rumour's going round and people are phoning in the rumour they've heard. Later that morning, I was informed of letters that had been left in a telephone box. Someone had found it, and then subsequently, police had gone up to that area to retrieve the letter. And when they come back, this is my recollection of it, another letter had been put on the windscreen of their car, saying the people responsible for the murder of Stephen and other stabbings that had occurred that they were involved in. At no stage at that point had we got any actual evidence. Somebody had called in at the police station or was given the name of Grant as a pseudonym, gave information, and obviously information isn't evidence. There is a distinct difference. The strategy was not to arrest. There were juveniles. You had to handle juveniles very carefully, obviously. To get them in, to simply release them, wasn't really making a lot of sense.
When Stephen was murdered, where was the support from the authorities? It wasn't there. And that's why we needed to exist.
Mr. Lawrence. Hi. I'm Mark from the ARA, and first of May, I offer my condolences to you and your family.
In the Greenwich area, Orville Blair, Roland Adams, Rohit Dugal. This was the fourth. They were allowing them to carry on in this violent, disordered way, and they weren't protecting us.
Doreen? Doreen?
The house has begun to fill up with people who I don't know. I spent all my time crying, so I wasn't talking to anybody, so I have no idea where they came from.
We had to call the doctor in to give her something to calm her down. She wasn't able to cope because she was so distraught.
And Imran was somebody that came to the house on the Sunday.
I was in my office, High Street practice, when I got a call saying there'd been a murder in Southeast London and could I get over there straight away?
I think what we need to do first, Mr. and Mrs. Lawrence, is to try and get some more background information.
There were two family liaison officers.
Where he went and who with and so on.
When I first met them, it was obvious from the way that they were asking questions that they were there to obtain information.
Well, the names of Stephen's best friends, perhaps.
They weren't coming to us and saying, we've got this evidence and we're just going through what we've got. They weren't doing any of that.
But why are you asking about black kids? It was killed by white kids, right?
No, we know that, Miss Smart.
What was troubling at the time is that on the Sunday...
Do you recognise...
..the family liaison officers were asking about some gloves that they'd found.
They were found at the scene.
Why did they need to know about these gloves?
Did Stephen have a pair of gloves like these?
What are you implying? Are you implying that my son was a cat burglar?
perhaps he might have recently acquired them to wear them when he went out at night.
And Enoch Stevens.
We got the impression that if you're black, you must be a thief. If you're black, you must be into drugs. You know, you're a criminal.
So I had to tell him to leave my house and don't come back.
By the Sunday, the information we had on the attackers was basically the same. Nothing to take us any further at that time. A surveillance was going to be put onto them the next day, which I'd arranged with a view to perhaps get some evidence of association, get to see what they looked like, whether they went to any other addresses. I was under that impression that was going to be occurring on the Monday morning. But it wasn't until later Monday, the photographer was there and took photographs of somebody coming out of the address with black bin liners. But they apparently never had a telephone with them or a radio to get in touch with anybody. And the surveillance team hadn't turned up on that at that occasion for whatever reason. But by then, of course, I wasn't aware of any of this, and I'd gone off the inquiry.
Do we know who this chap is?
Detective Superintendent Crampton. His role was taken over by Detective Superintendent Whedon.
Surely, I mean, if you know the motive is racial, you should be already looking for racialists.
I can understand it may seem quite a simple matter, say, yes, go and look for racialists, but, of course, it's rather more complex than that.
Listen, I live on the estate, right, and there's some kid there who reckons that he's seen some boys washing their clothes and cleaning up a knife.
The neighbourhood got involved instantly.
People on the estate know who they are.
They've done other acts of violence. I think they were kind of terrorising the community.
What's your name, Ray?
Listen, I'm really, you know what I mean, it's not, I can't tell you that.
We had information that people were trying to give to the police. There were actual addresses given that were ignored. The letter that I wrote on the Monday was, can you tell us what's happening? What happened in the incident? What are you doing about it? It was a straightforward, inquisitorial letter. And it's unanswered. You write another letter and it's unanswered. I had no information to go on. The message was coming back to the Lawrences that Duane wasn't being treated well by the police. They had real concerns about him.
I'd like to speak to the officer in charge of the Stephen Lawrence inquiry.
I had no information to go on. I was ringing the police.
You see the problem, Mr. Whedon?
Trying to get information and meeting a brick wall.
All they'd like to know is when you plan to make arrests.
What do we want?
Justice!
When do we want it?
Now!
What do we want?
Justice!
When do we want it?
Now!
Hundreds of people have taken part in a vigil in southeast London tonight in protest against race attacks.
Now there is anger that has strengthened their resolve to help find Stephen's killers.
One murder, two murder, three murder, four murder is more than enough. We can't take any more of it. And something has got to be done. And enough is enough.
I think Neville, to me at least, felt like he almost became monosyllabic. I don't think I really heard him speak much after that. He's the sort of guy that would chuckle a lot, and that just ended. But the grief, the sense of grief, it was really hard to be around Doreen after that, because it was so palpable. The waves of grief radiating off of her, and the pensiveness. It's not something, it's not easy to be around. It's not something that you can never really get used to. In later life, I've experienced death of loved ones. My dad passed away a few years ago. It's not the same. It's harrowing. But also the outrage, the realization that we don't live in this fairy tale world that we've created for ourselves. It came crashing in.
Stephen is regarded as the fourth young victim of racial murder here in the past 2 years.
We have talk and we have talk. And I'm saying the talking is over. Now it's time for action.
Action.
We have to take
action.
Our...
Yes.
We have to deal with it ourselves.
Action.
I mean, we're saying...
What does action mean, though? What action, kind of action?
Action means by any means necessary. Yeah.
The senior policeman who runs this area was telling me today that the advice he'd give you lot is to think seriously about joining the police force. He hasn't got enough. Do you have a good relationship with the police?
No.
No.
Can't trust them, but it's one. They pick you up for nothing.
all jacking up and shit just because you're black. Ain't you right, man?
In the old days, trying to get the police to treat something as a racist crime was almost impossible. You'd have to have somebody say, my motivation in doing this is because I'm a racist. That is what you'd need. This is years, decades, centuries of culture that has as part of its DNA an assumption about the black communities.
When you were black and you were a victim of crime and you called the police, the tendency was that the police somehow would start to investigate you. And everybody understood it. Everybody knew it.
We can go as far back as the 50s, the 70s, the 80s with the Brixton riots, you know. The same thing keeps coming up. We're not being treated fairly. We're not being treated fairly. What, is that a chip on the shoulder? Is that stuff just the imagination? The unsolved murders, you know, of black youths, someone's imagination? Come on.
I found it hard speaking to people because I needed help. And there was nobody to help that had experienced what I had experienced. I was treated as a person that didn't have any feelings because I was just a main witness. A main witness. What the fuck does a main witness mean to anybody?
The rumors that we heard was that Dwayne ran away and left Stephen. And in our early days, nobody would run away and leave the other.
I don't know. I don't know why he didn't run. But he was always of the view that if he didn't do anything wrong to anybody, then he wouldn't run from something like that. For me, I'm not taking that kind of chance because danger is danger.
He knows he's, you know, forever will be the man that ran away and left his mate. He knows that. And I think Mrs. Lawrence hasn't forgiven him. They've never spoken, have they, since? No, they haven't.
I wanted to hear from him what had happened, and he's never spoken to me.
You want him to have the answers. You want to make sense of the madness. And in that, you maybe forget that he's just a teenage boy that was running for his life.
We're supposed to have our trust in them and we think they're doing a wonderful job. Well, that is, that's just a joke, because I don't believe they're doing a wonderful job.
Them times I was really angry because all the stories that you've heard of what happened to young black men, and then you begin to think about, had he been white?
They would have surrounded a black community. They would have arrested as many black boys as they could, and they would not stop until they get the killer.
But for Stephen, they're hoping that, you know, I would just shut up and go away.
United we stand and divided we fall, and that's how it should be. We should be united.
One of the liaison officers said, if you were to come down to the police station, you see all the work and all the stuff that we're doing. And I asked, why would I need to do that? It's your job. They weren't giving us information. People came and gave us the boys' names. Those are the only things that we knew.
We've been getting calls. If they're telling us, I'm sure they must be telling you.
We need evidence, Mrs. Lawrence.
Sure.
Hard information.
I just got a bit of paper and I wrote all the names down and I handed the paper to this officer. And I sat there and I would listen to all the discussion that was going on. And in the meantime, he would just fold the paper up, oblivious to me being there. And he folded it and he folded and he folded it. So as I was walking out the door, I said, you're going to put that in the bin now, aren't you? And that when he realised that I was watching him.
No, I'm seriously thinking that we're better off living in a community where we're surrounded more with blacks.
Isn't there a danger that in doing that, though, that you polarise the whole situation so it becomes us and them, which is exactly what you do. What else
can we do? Because the police are not really protecting our kids.
To make this work for the news media, you have to deliver up some photo opportunities. The South African exile living in Britain phoned me up and said, Nelson Mandela is coming to London. Would you like him to meet Doreen and Neville? And of course I said, Hell yes.
Remember the door opened and I saw this tall, elegant looking man come in. And I'm thinking, I'm in a dream.
We brought over Nelson Mandela to energize the white community. The contrast between the failure of British domestic politicians and the willingness of Nelson Mandela to become involved, I think, tells its own story.
We are very used to this type of thing where life is regarded as cheap in South Africa. But nevertheless, it's a sense of disconcern that it should happen in a country like Britain.
Your tragedy is our tragedy. Nelson
Getting Mandela on board changed it from a local story to a national story. More importantly, the next day were the arrests.
Today, they raided two addresses in South London.
So without him, those first arrests would never have happened.
I honestly don't believe there was any linkage between Nelson Mandela or anything he said and the timing of the arrests.
With the same amount of information that they had, from when they was telling that they can't arrest, they arrested these guys days after.
Because of the sensitivity surrounding this case, the police are saying little about the people they're questioning.
They didn't tell us about the arrest. We saw it on the local news. So anything that we wanted to know about how the investigation was happening, we'll see it on the news when they so choose to do something.
And you are?
Jamie Arthur Acle.
You've been arrested in connection with the murder of a Stephen Lawrence. Do you remember the night, the 22nd of April?
No, I can't remember.
When your house was searched this morning, in your room, two knives were found. Tell me why you've got those knives.
No comment. Can you give me a full name, please?
Neil Charles Acle.
Today, you stood on an identification parade and you were picked out by Dwayne Brooks. What have you got to say about that?
No comment.
Why do you go around stabbing people?
No comment.
Or is it anybody who wants to be a friend with you has to prove themselves by stabbing somebody?
No comment.
David Alan Norris.
Are you going to tell us where you were that night?
No reply.
Do you remember that night?
No reply.
I'm told by Stacey Benefield, you pulled a miniature sword, he describes it as. You said, shut up, you cunt, and then stabbed him in the chest. Have you anything to say about that?
No reply.
My name's Gary George Dobson.
Someone's obviously trying to point a finger at me.
Well, someone definitely has pointed a finger at you, more than one person, son.
That makes me look like I don't like blacks.
Have we suggested it was a racist attack?
No, that's what the paper's saying it.
Personally, I don't think it was a particularly racist attack. I think it's incidental. I'll stop the report.
I remember everyone was extremely angry. There's going to be this demonstration down at BNP. Our time for revenge.
Roland Adams dead. Last year they murdered Rohit Dugal in Eltham in Wellhole Road. Another person has been murdered, Stephen Lawrence, on the same road in Wellhole Road.
The Black Panthers came to see me and they said, would I lead the march they're calling to close the BNP headquarters?
What are we going to do to them?
Tonight, anti-race groups are calling on Bexley Council to close down the British National Party's headquarters at Welling.
I had decided that I didn't want to be part of any kind of march. Duane had approached and asked if we wanted to be down there and I said no.
I know that I was angry, and I know that I wanted to go, and I was there. Anything that was associated with racism, because Steve was killed, was a target.
In the front of the march was Dwayne Brooks, and that's the day Dwayne was seen to overturn a BMW car that day.
We were attacked as black militants who had hijacked this poor, grieving family. And the Daily Mail was in the forefront of that negative reporting.
I saw the picture of the family meeting Mandela in the middle of this. I kind of was taken back by the fact that the paper had seen it fit to put us in the middle of all this violence when we had nothing to do with it. So the Daily Mail sent some journalist to do a story. And I said to him, who is the editor? And he said, Paul Dacre. And I said, oh. And he said to me, do I need to get the number? And I said, no. And he said, why not? I said, well, I have it.
We bought a house that needed a lot of work doing. I think one of the neighbors recommended that Neville Lawrence was a very good plasterer. He came and did some plastering for the house. I remember this very quietly spoken man, very sensitive man.
He apologized and said to me, Mr. Lawrence, I didn't realize it was your son.
I said, well, look, if you want to put the record straight, give us an interview. And sure enough, a couple of days later, the Mail carried a full exclusive interview with Dorian and Neville. He made it very clear that he didn't want to have anything to do with the protests.
Various different factions were trying to co-opt what was happening. Although people seemed to be suggesting that they wanted to be supportive, it didn't feel like that. It felt like jackals feeding on a carcass.
Yes, there were tensions. Lots of anti-racist organisations jockeying for pole position.
When we had criticism, we withdrew.
Hold on. At the end of the day, the Lawrence family wrote to you and told you literally to get lost.
And it's not to say that their causes weren't just. They were. But we just need to maintain our focus on Stephen's attackers.
Arriving at court this morning, the 17-year-old charged with the murder of Stephen Lawrence.
So you've come here just to see the face of the man charged?
I wouldn't mind seeing the face of the youngster who is being charged for his murder.
We would all like to see his face, actually. We're disgusted with his behaviour. We're here today to see that bloody justice is done.
It was a positive moment. You know, there was some confidence thinking that we're going to get somewhere.
It seemed to be closing the chapter because I couldn't do any more now. This was it. We'd achieved our objective. They were arrested, and then they were charged.
The Lawrences are appealing for calm at tomorrow's memorial service at their local church. They say Stephen will be buried in Jamaica next month because Britain doesn't deserve him.
This is another one of those numb days. You just go through the motion. You know, you just go through the motion of being there. For me, it's just making sure everybody knew Stephen was killed. Everybody needs to know what happened to my son. Police asked if they could come to the service, and I said, no, we don't want you in there. To me, why?
My coping mechanism was to distance myself from personal. I almost placed myself as a steward, that as a pallbearer at the funeral. I've always been very proud of being from a mixed heritage. I've always been very proud of both sides of my culture, of being black and white, and that never changed. But it was tested, absolutely tested.
Many of us feel ashamed to be white.
I still hadn't accepted the fact that Stephen was dead. When you read the Bible, it tells you, in the days of Moses and the Pharaoh, one of the punishments that used to be dished out was if you did something wrong, you lose your firstborn. And so I'm thinking, maybe I done something wrong.
I got the papers, two suspects who'd been charged, and they were due to be committed for trial. The evidence presented to us in the summer of 1993 involved only one real issue, and that was of identification. Was there sufficient quality identification evidence to carry the case forward? The only real identifying witness was Mr. Dwayne Brooks, and all that he could say was that they were white, they were wearing jeans, and were young. A fleeting glimpse. That by itself made the evidence very, very weak. And that already weak evidence was further undermined by a conversation that Dwayne had with an officer called Sergeant Crowley.
Look carefully, and if you do recognize anyone.
On the third ID parade, I was picked up by Sergeant Crowley. That particular time, I picked out Luke Knight, and I remember Crowley, in his statement, he said that I had told him that I was picking out suspects based on descriptions given to me by friends. And Crowley's statement was used to discredit me.
I don't remember a case where a conversation following an identification parade had such a dramatic effect. Dwayne originally denied the accuracy of Sergeant Crowley's statement, but when a statement was taken from Dwayne Brooks to explain it, he himself did accept that he had been given some information. And it seemed to me the case was, in layman's terms, virtually hopeless. No lawyer of any competence could have said we had enough.
Two teenagers accused of murdering the black schoolboy Stephen Lawrence have been released from custody after the Crown Prosecution Service ruled there was insufficient evidence against them.
I was so angry, so angry.
A black boy's got to the age of 18. He hasn't got a criminal record. He's not into drugs. He's not into carrying knives. He doesn't hang about the street corners. He's a studious person. He goes to school and to college. They can't accept that.
I just had enough. I just really, really had enough. And I was gone.
You see, Darren?
I never start ringing around trying to find out where I am.
No, because she said that she would be home by 3 o'clock.
And nobody knew where I was. I didn't tell anybody either. They're out looking for me.
So what makes you think she's gone to Wellow Road?
Well, I don't know whether she's gone to Wellow Road.
But... yeah, well, look. On the right over there, look.
You know, I just needed to think and question what's going on.
Oh, God, she's crying.
I'm going to find out what the police know and what they're hiding from us. And if they won't prosecute, we'll prosecute, won't we? Yeah?
All right.
I think the worst possible thing that can happen to a mother happened to her. So what more could be done? I mean, there's a fearlessness that comes with that. That's sort of like, okay, you've done the worst thing possible, so now this is nothing taking you on.
The killers are still out on the street. My son had a future, and they've taken that away. And I just feel as if they're laughing at us. There's nobody, I think, who looked to pacify me. Nobody could tell me no. I presume they could, but I wouldn't accept it. I wouldn't accept it.
I think it's October. I got arrested for violent disorder in a demonstration against the BNP.
Mr. Brooks, we're arresting you on suspicion of causing criminal damage on May the 8th of this year.
I think an officer who by chance was on one of the identification parades basically said he recognized Dwayne Brooks as being involved in the wedding riots.
My name is Jane Dighton and I am Dwayne Brooks's solicitor. There we have the victim of a violent, murderous, racist attack being prosecuted for violent disorder, whereas the original perpetrators of the attack, not a single one of them was being prosecuted.
I'm sorry, but that's riotous behaviour. And Dwayne was on camera with others overturning a car.
If you have a key witness commits a serious offence, what are the police and the prosecution to do?
What they were doing, in effect, was gnawing away at the reliability and credibility of one of their own key witnesses.
It's the system, the institution, society. Every time you wanted the case to move forward, something would happen in the Met Police that meant it moved backwards. And Dwayne's arrest and his treatment by the police gave the impression there was a deliberate attempt by the authorities to completely undermine his evidence forevermore.
Teenager Stephen Lawrence killed by a gang of white youth were demanding some answers today.
I think people see me and they think, oh, well, you know, she's done so well, she's so strong. that's not the case. You know, behind the scene, you know, I was a wreck. I don't know how I got through that Christmas. That Christmas was awful. But I wouldn't say it's hard to remember when we were all happy, because as a family, we did a lot of things together. Stephen's last Christmas was like, they had the chores to do, and he was to wash up after dinner. And of course, Christmas, you use practically every pot that you have in your cupboard. And he just said to me, I want a photograph taken of this. I can't believe it's my turn, and I've got all this to wash up. And so, you know, you can laugh at that, because it was funny that. So there's a photo of him with his headphones on.
Nearly every Christmas, Doreen would ring, and it would be, we've let them win. We've been too soft, we haven't done this, we haven't done that, we've got to do something else. And I couldn't have imagined what it was like on her end of the phone.
I couldn't bear the mere fact that nobody's been held for Stephen's murder. You know, he didn't kill himself. For me, it was always, always about getting to the truth.
An 18-year-old boy has been stabbed to death. Stephen Lawrence was killed as he waited for a bus.
Because of the sensitivity surrounding this case, the police are saying little about the people they're questioning.
Two teenagers accused of murdering the black schoolboy Stephen Lawrence have been released from custody.
Crown Prosecution Service dropped the charges at the end of July 1993. There's no relationship that we have with the police. There's no investigation that's ongoing. There's nobody in government listening. But for my part, it wasn't a question of, well, that's the end of it. We haven't got what we want. We had to sit down and think in terms of strategy. I grew up in the east end of London, Newham. Growing up at that time meant that whenever you were out, you could be a target for any white person who wanted to humiliate you, attack you.
We support Enoch Powell! We support Enoch Powell!
We had the words of Enoch Powell ringing in our ears.
In 15 or 20 years' time, the black man will have the whip hand over the white man.
It's always politicians who set the parameters of how society behaves.
I can already hear the chorus of execration.
Keep Britain white!
It immediately filtered down and gave every white person carte blanche to attack any Asian, Afro-Caribbean person they saw. And on one occasion, I recall that a young boy spat at me. That young white boy knew even at that age that he could get away with it, because if I had taken action at the time, who knows what the consequences might have been, not just for me, but my family. And that really is what racism is all about. It's not the animosity of a single individual, it's what's behind that individual. It's the system, the institution, society. And it's that system which Doreen is railing against.
As far as I was concerned, Stephen's death was still a debt of honour that we'd not yet repaid. Doreen, I wanted her to trust and believe that we were going to do everything we could, but I'm certain that I never persuaded her.
The original investigation had been running for about a year, and somebody made the decision that they needed a fresh look at the suspects, the A-courts, Dobson, Luke Knight, and Norris. The first inquiry had been told, and I was told, that there would be no blood. Stephen Lawrence, he had three or four layers of clothing. As the knife came out, the blood would have been kept by the clothing inside. So our strategy was to target Clifford Norris, who was the father of one of the suspects. He was on the run for half a ton of cannabis. He's a thoroughbred gangster.
Bill Mellish felt that Clifford Norris was a barrier between the police effectively doing their job in South East London. Now, that tells you he's clearly had a relationship with police officers investigating Stephen's murder. Whether it was a corrupt relationship, we've got no proof about that.
Norris, his wife, lived in a rather nice house with the son. We did surveillance. We took the contents of their dustbin and it contained a birthday card from old man Norris. You couldn't make out the postmark, but he had a British stamp, so he was in the country somewhere. And as luck would have it, surveillance took Mum and the boy down to Battle in Sussex, to some post houses. I called out the world and his brother, firearms people, regional crime squad. Norris came out, and as they came out, the armed officers jumped on them. In the Oast House was a sawn off shotgun and an Uzi submachine gun. Norris got 8 years, 8 years imprisonment.
And then the opportunity arose for them to secretly film the suspects. A camera was surreptitiously put in place in Gary Dobson's flat. And that was the base that the A Corps and Norris and Luke Knight used.
Main supply.
We were lucky. Gary Dobson moved in with his girlfriend to a flat off the estate. We made a technical intrusion, which gave us audio and visual. And they met most evenings.
You know that Enoch was how?
It just showed them to be rabid racists with a propensity to violence on a regular basis. Every night they went out, they would take the machete off of the windowsill by the front door, and one of them would stick it down his belt. We were getting that on video on a nightly basis.
There's a nigger there who died, he broke his shot a few years ago. I had the Stanley knife in my pocket, pulled it out, bit the thing off. And I went, that'll do there, make me find that cut his arm.
This is the transcripts, was chilling. Viewing it was even worse.
I'm telling you, I'll take my skin and black hand to life. Torture and set him alive. I'll blow their two legs and arms on the same point.
You know, I'm squirming. You're not a big roll. You're sitting in a barrel. You've
been bowling around like that.
We knew then that we were dealing with people who were more than capable of inflicting the fatal blows on Stephen.
Good evening. There was another blow today for the family of a black student stabbed to death by a gang of white youths in southeast London a year ago. The Crown Prosecution Service said new evidence on the killing of Stephen Lawrence wasn't strong enough to take the case to court. I'm joined now by Stephen's father, but by, I do apologise, Stephen's mother, Mrs. Doreen Lawrence. What are you going to do now? There's been talk of a private prosecution. Are you going to go ahead with that?
We'll be discussing this with our solicitor over the next few days.
But what chance, sorry to interrupt you, but what chance have you got with a private prosecution if the Crown Prosecution Service is saying, well, we're sorry, we don't have the evidence to make it stand up in court?
Well, I mean, so the evidence is out there.
The Lawrences sat down to a meeting with the Crown Prosecution Service.
I decided that I'm not going to accept the fact that they have said that there is no case to answer. And if they're not going to go any further, we were going to take the case up ourselves, win or lose.
The DPP would look bad coming in and taking over if we don't say anything.
As lawyers, we knew that a private prosecution was possible. No one in their right mind was thinking that we would do it.
So far as witnesses and any difficulties, should we get
Michael Mansfield, who was the QC, talked to him and wondered aloud whether we could do this.
And after that, the problems begin to arise in a different way because the Director of Public Prosecutions has the right to intervene in all this. We all knew it was risky. We all knew that this is very rare.
We all knew the authorities had been looking at this very closely.
No, I'm sorry, Mr. Maxwell's in conference.
Because obviously there was double jeopardy, which meant that once you had a finding of not guilty against you, you could never be prosecuted against. So there was a huge risk, there were huge stakes. We were playing with huge stakes.
If we do fail at any stage, then the suspect will be acquitted and walk free forever.
The alternative was we accept the state not prosecuting, and what are we left with?
At the time, I didn't realise that it's 150 years since they've had a private prosecution. I wasn't fazed by that, because I was focused on what I thought that we had. You know, once the jury heard this, the jury will convict them.
Ready or not, here I come. You can't hide. Gonna find you and take it slowly.
Exactly 2 years after the death of their son, Neville and Doreen Lawrence have begun private proceedings which, if successful, will make legal history.
Summonses have been issued against four individuals considered to be responsible for the murder of Stephen Lawrence.
I must confess, it was an exciting time. Frightening, but exciting, because we were now in control of this process.
The authorities usually expect people to roll over, give up, go away, evaporate. That's what they want.
Four teenagers have been remanded in custody, charged with the murder of Stephen Lawrence.
But you're dealing here with two people who, from the beginning, were not prepared to accept, no, we can't do it, or rejection or denial.
Obviously, both myself and the family are happy that proceedings have now started.
It's very difficult to mount a prosecution privately. You need the assistance of the police because they've got the resources. They've also got whatever evidence there is.
We had an investment in desperately wanting to succeed for the reputation of the Met. And so we worked very, very hard to persuade the CPS to cooperate.
Number one, that's a letter for me.
My role was to provide all the information that the police had at that time. We used to meet regularly with Imran Khan and Mr. Mansfield in his chambers, and we were all quite buoyed. I think we did stand a chance, but I think everybody was aware that evidentially this was a, you know, we were on thin ice in some places here.
This was the first time that we saw material from the police. We were sent thousands and thousands of pages of statements. We'd read through all of it. We had a team working on this. We'd have conferences at Michael Mansfield's chambers.
The Acourt brothers, Dobson, Norris.
All the things that we suspected, the deluge of names and information coming in within hours of the murder, all of that was there in black and white, precisely what the police could have done, should have done, and didn't do. The most difficult part was that we had to present a case. And if we could see the failures, well, the defendants could as well.
The reality is that the video was circumstantial evidence. We had no witnesses that put them at the scene of the crime. The people at the bus stop, God bless them, couldn't identify anybody. During the first inquiry, Crowley came back and reported. Dwayne Brooks was not a reliable witness. No forensic.
I think I felt uneasy that there were too many obvious things that had not happened. The exhibits had not been handled carefully at all in this particular case, nor had the scene. But it also occurred to me that the recording of what they were doing, one could show motivation and intention. You don't have to do that for murder, but it helps. And Acourt, with the knife, goes, "This is how you do it." And what he did, the action he did with the knife, coming out of this side of the hand, not like this, but like that, you go, whoa, like this. Now, interestingly, the pathology in the case showed that that is exactly the action that would have caused the knife injury to Stephen. On its own, it wouldn't get us past the threshold, but together with the identification, we thought there, once we had that on film, that we had a much stronger case.
The white boys had got to the zebra crossing just there. One of them shouted out, "What? What, nigger?" I looked up. They started all running at him. I go to Stephen to run, and then I turned myself and ran that way.
Nobody seemed to be thinking about what this might mean for me. A teenager hasn't recovered from the trauma and is finding it difficult to cope.
As I shouted at him, one of the white boys ran into him with one big long thing, like that, about 2 foot long. And he made one loud screaming noise.
The choice would have been me saying, I'm not prepared to give evidence. It's Dwayne Brooks's fault that the case has collapsed. Or the other side of that is to go along and do the best that you possibly can, knowing that your best isn't good enough at this stage.
At Belmarsh today, grieving parents driven to bring their own private prosecution against the news they say stabbed their 18-year-old son to death. Neil Acourt, Jamie Acourt, David Norris and Luke Knight, seen here hiding their faces, appeared at court for the committal process which will rule whether they should stand trial.
So that's the first time I saw them. And you want to say something? Like, these idiots murdered Stephen. You know, they don't have a life, really. My son did. My son had a future. And they've taken that away.
I saw one of them pulling out something from his jacket. And before that, shouted out, what, nigger. And then they was on him.
That was the first time I'm hearing from Dwayne. We'd all the while I'm hearing rumors, thinking that he ran away and left Stephen. He didn't.
Snatched glances a few seconds at most.
Listen, I saw what I saw.
I rule that the case against Neil Acourt, Gary Dobson, and Luke Knight is sufficient to warrant going forward for consideration by a jury.
The parents of the murdered teenager Stephen Lawrence today secured a rare legal victory.
No family should ever have to experience the last 2 years of our lives. This is the worst kind of fame. We have been brought into the public spotlight, not by our own acts, but by the failure of others who were under the public duty to act. We have come this far without the Crown Prosecution Service, and it is our wish now to continue to the end without their involvement.
It's really frustrating that I can't separate Stephen's death from Stephen's life. And with Dorian and Neville, I saw two people who can't even console themselves, let alone find solace in each other.
So outwardly, there was a joint approach to campaign for justice. Inwardly, all sorts of issues were flaring up and needed to be resolved.
We've never talked about what each other was going through.
Let us pray.
We were never able to sit down and discuss with each other how anybody felt about what was happening. It was never done. It's still never been done. All these years, we still haven't never been able to sit and talk to each other about how much pain each of us was going through.
I noticed, more or less from the same night that Stephen was killed, how things just changed, just like that. People say it either makes you stronger together or it tears you apart. I had to keep it together for everybody. And I expected some support from him, and it wasn't there. I used to come home from uni, and he would be there all day, so he wouldn't do anything, so I had to come home and cook. Then he would eat, and then he'd go upstairs to the bedroom, and that's where he would stay. It was as if the tragedy only happened to him and the rest of us wasn't going through anything.
It was like I was in a different country or a different space. I was totally consumed with grief.
Wow.
One of the unique things about the private prosecution was that both Imran Khan and Michael Mansfield were defence advocates. I remember mentioning to Mr. Mansfield that this is probably the first and only time he's going to be prosecuting counsel, which I think he agreed with me on. But it was always going to rely on Dwayne Brooks. He was the key witness.
Dwayne, I can understand the situation that he was in, but then we were relying on his evidence to convict these guys.
That experience at the Old Bailey was very upsetting. My main concern was about my safety. And I was in the court where everybody in the public gallery could see me. I was extremely frightened, but constantly told, there's nothing to worry about, Mr. Brooks. You'll be looked after. Okay, thank you. Everybody who was saying to me at that time, you'll be looked after, didn't know that Sergeant Cole was going to be the person to take me away on one of those nights.
They took him to Eltham one night, which was a frightening place for him to be. But after that, he discovered through the McPherson inquiry that one of the officers that did look after him was in fact an officer called Sergeant Coles. Now, Sergeant Coles was to have been an officer who came under suspicion for having potentially corrupt relations with a member of the Norris family. And of course, Norris was one of the suspects who was being investigated. Obviously, afterwards, a real fear for Dwayne was that Coles had been deployed for the purposes of intimidating him one way or another. It's absolutely terrifying. I mean, it's double terrifying. It's not just that you're under threat, but that your guards may be the people threatening you.
The fickle finger of fate dictated that whoever was allocating people, and it wasn't us, it was the local divisional people. If you've got any spare people around, Mellish wants two escorts for a witness. And they would have been sent up. So I had no part in it.
Although the jury were empaneled and sworn, basically, to try the case, they were sent away because an application was made in the court to throw the case out based upon the quality of the identification evidence in the case.
And that went on for a whole week. Every time anything of any relevance were going to be discussed, they've asked the jury to leave. I was getting a bit worried then, because if the jury not hearing anything...
There was this attempt, in a sense, to undermine Dwayne Brooks.
A couple of things undermined my evidence. One was, naturally, it was a fleeting glance, but also the evidence of Crowley accusing me of picking out one of the suspects, Neil Acor. It's from what other people had described.
Dwayne gave his evidence, but he didn't come across as being, you know, entirely consistent and reliable.
I'm the roller coaster at this point, because I'm on the front line. I'm arguing in front of the judge, and I'm having to go back to the Lawrences and say, he's ruled it out.
Today, the judge ruled that vital eyewitness evidence was inadmissible.
On that day, I felt that I had let myself down and everybody else down.
We needed the identification. Even with the video, it's not enough. This was a package. And if the identifications are going to go, I had to say to the Lawrences, sorry, I don't think we're going to survive this case.
To see these actual people who we feel murdered our son to be walking out of that court scot-free wasn't easy to accept.
Neil, how do you feel? Neil, come on, just give us some reaction. How do you feel? Neil, what about the video evidence, eh?
They'd lost their son in the most tragic of circumstances. The police had done nothing about it, and now their own lawyers had failed. I remember that was the day that Doreen collapsed. She just crumpled.
I was holding myself together for so long, and that was just the straw that broke the camel back for me. you know, because by then I had nothing more. It's like you tried everything, and everything they threw at you, you got up again and you keep going, and this was the last straw.
I don't think what happened today is fair at all. And as you can see, my wife is not here today, so you can just judge how she feels.
You know, the jury didn't hear them. The jury didn't... There's no questioning. They never heard anything.
I don't know of any other case, anyway, where a prosecutor's forced to open the case without referring to any of the evidence that links the defendants to the particular trial.
It's fingertip time. You're hanging on here. And I was trying to instill in them a sense of hope, even in these dire circumstances, dark circumstances, that, you know, a phoenix will arise from these ashes, and it'll only arise if we create it, if we help it.
I got to the stage where I couldn't even stand to walk up and down in the place. And I was told by my doctor to take a spell away.
I've been through 3 hard years of pain and suffering, and I don't think I can take anymore.
His anger has kept me going so far, because without it, I think I'll just crumble and people just walk over me. I never might put up with it, but I certainly am not going to have that.
Stephen's buried next to my grandmother in Jamaica.
It's been a long time, boy, so...
With Neville, I noticed the distance, that he was really distant. My aunt suggested, because things were really difficult, that maybe he needs a break. Nobody thought about I may need a break, but he may need a break. So all that time, all the inquest was just me.
I couldn't go to another court thing, and I stayed in Jamaica until after it finished.
The inquest into the death and the coroner's court, Sir Montague Devine, effectively means that the criminal case is over. This is the end, because you only have an inquest when all other proceedings are done and dusted.
Witnesses have been summoned before this inquest today.
And for us, this wasn't now about getting justice for Stephen. The focus was now the police and what had happened in 93. The police who were assisting us accepted that things had gone badly wrong in the first investigation. So we wanted John Cant to simply accept that.
I was obviously called to give evidence in front of the coroner on the manner and means of death. And then Mr. Mansfield started asking me questions about first inquiry, and they never got into any great discussions with me about holes or flaws in the first investigation. And I think one of the things that I mentioned was the fact that family liaison, the Lawrences thought they weren't doing their job properly. The SIO was feeling bamboozled with all these questions, which he then had to deal with, probably was a bit of a distraction.
The only problem was between the family and the liaison officers. It was my fault, you know, it's the family's fault. I think I was so mad.
John Cant gave evidence, knowing full well what our views were, and he couldn't bring himself to say that the police had failed.
I thought that line of question was actually inappropriate for a coroner's inquest, because this was now moving into the realms of criticising the first inquiry, as opposed to establishing, you know, how Stephen died.
And it felt like typical police behaviour. But they were bound by this code of, we can't criticise our fellow officers.
I was really angry, and I just said, right there and then, I want to know what happened to my son. I want to know what the police did. I want to know everything.
I will now be making a formal complaint against the Metropolitan Police, and particularly those officers concerned who did not take action where they should have taken action on the night of the 22nd of April, 1993.
It was unrelenting criticism. Not a smile. That was her gimmick. Not a smile. I think, aided and abetted by her legal team, she was a formidable force. I'm not sure that, in her own right, she was ever a formidable force. Imran Khan was extreme left-wing. Imran Khan was a candidate, I think, on one election for a Socialist Working Party, or certainly extreme left-wing party. And Mansfield, extreme left-wing. We would assuredly have been accused of racism.
At the inquest, Doreen stands and delivers a speech she has written about how the case had been mishandled and how the country had failed the black community.
When my son was murdered, the police saw him as a criminal belonging to a gang.
There was Doreen saying what a lot of us had known and felt for years.
My son's crime was that he was walking down the road looking for a bus that would take him home. Our crime is living in a country where the justice system supports racist murderers against innocent people.
The value that this white, racist country puts on black lives is evident.
But still, we followed all the steps open to us. But one by one, the doors were closed in our faces.
In my opinion, what happened was the way of the judicial system making a clear statement.
To make clear to black people in this country that before the law, their lives were worth nothing.
Personally, it meant a great deal. My own family were immigrants, so I understood where a lot of what was being said came from.
I'm joined now by our reporter who was in court, Rita Chakrabarty. Rita,
for me, it was a huge case. I was quite a young reporter then and found myself in the middle of this enormous story. My impressions of the principal suspects, this was the first time anyone had seen the five of them, they came over as cocky, as wanting to play the role that had been assigned to them, embracing that role of being public enemies, if you like.
Neil Acourt?
The suspects of the inquest, it was surreal. They attended, they gave no evidence, and they treated the proceedings with utter contempt.
Do you have any information that would help this jury regarding the circumstances of the murder of Stephen Lawrence?
On my solicitor's advice, I exercised my right to silence.
What were you doing on the night of April the 22nd, 1993?
On my solicitor's advice, I exercised my right to silence.
Because they didn't want to start answering any questions. Why? Because obviously they thought there was a risk that they would incriminate themselves. I think that says quite a lot.
Did you come here today prepared to assist this court?
On my solicitor's advice, I exercised my right to remain silent.
And the mere fact that these boys would not even answer their name, it was no comment, no comment. And it's that they were just sticking two fingers up.
What is your name?
On my solicitor's advice, I exercised my right to remain silent.
People were appalled, and I rushed out afterwards and filed for radio.
He did acknowledge that the Lawrence family had been very anxious that the police had acted too slowly initially.
But that was the day that then led to the Daily Mail's big headline.
I remember last day of the inquest very, very vividly. That day, by an amazing piece of serendipity, we had a meeting with Sir Paul Condon, and Stephen Lawrence's case came up. I remember him saying that he'd bet his life the five suspects were as guilty as sin. The tragedy was the police couldn't get the evidence necessary, the CPS wouldn't back them in a prosecution, but he was absolutely certain they were guilty.
These men were killers. One sensed the palpable frustration of the man.
So we had the lunch, I thought nothing more of it. But that night, the 9 o'clock news came on, and it showed the five suspects These guys were taking the piss out of British justice. That moment, I picked up a layout pad and I wrote down the word murderers in huge type and underlined it. And then wrote a subdeck underneath it. The Mail accused these men of killing. If we are wrong, sue us. There was a kind of deathly silence on the back bench, some nervous titters. Someone joked, what about libel? The libel thing was a risk. Bear in mind, this was now about 9:10. And if you haven't worked on newspapers, you don't understand the sheer tyranny of the clock. We had to have the last page to the printers by 9:45. Conversation with lawyer, 9:10. 20-minute conversation with deputy in the office. Huge tension. We were doing something pretty cataclysmic. But you trust your instincts. You go with what you believe is right. I'm Neville Lawrence. Yes, I'm a human being. I knew the man. He was clearly a very decent, very hard-working man. Would the Mail have still done that headline without that knowledge? Probably not. Anyway, the next morning, the SHIT hit the fan.
Trial by media or a last recourse when justice itself has failed. The legalistic and journalistic arguments continue.
The action of the Daily Mail has without doubt interfered with the course of justice.
Friends and family of the five young men accused of the murder say angrily that they have been tried, convicted and condemned by the media.
What happened to them boys? Anyone in their place would hold a privilege.
Our sons aren't racist.
You say your sons aren't racist, but we've all seen the video.
They was hitting back with words only after 18 months of persecution.
And Mrs. Acord, on that tape, we saw one of your sons wielding a knife.
Mm. Well, I don't think it did suggest violence at all.
What, wielding a knife like that?
Yeah, wielding a knife. It was over play acting. You could see that on that camera.
It was a very daring move by the Mail. It put absolute rocket boosters under the story.
It's a national newspaper, read by millions, read by politicians. It's arrived into the houses that have never understood or experienced racism. I can't deny that there was a mischievous grin on my face when that was said, but also a sense of unease.
Strictly speaking, as a lawyer, I found that difficult. The day in which we live in a society when the Daily Mail adjudicates on guilt or innocence, I think, is a sad day.
It hasn't restored my faith in justice, because justice is still not done. What the coroner's court has done is to prove that Stephen was murdered unprovoked. That is what they've done. And what the press have done is highlight that even more so and making it come home to people.
With tradition signalling a determination to do things differently, the Blairs walked into Downing Street to be cheered by hundreds of party workers.
The next thing that we knew is that we had an appointment with Jack Straw.
The police service under Margaret Thatcher had been almost deliberately made unaccountable. They were judge and jury in their own cause. And where things went wrong, there was no one really able to hold them to account. You had the famous headline in the Daily Mail, and that helped to change the politics of this quite dramatically, because by virtue of the fact it was the Mail and not a leftish paper, it made for space for me to then push for an inquiry. The problem was that Labour was seen, in the parody anyway, as a party of soft liberality and indulgence of criminals. Tony Blair got interested in this, and Tony was rather anxious that if I was going to set up this inquiry, there were good reasons for doing so. And he was also anxious that, if possible, I should agree the terms of reference with the Metropolitan Police Commissioner. So there was a lot of toing and throwing and toing and froing.
Colonel Bradford, when he was commissioner in 1890, lost his arm on a tiger shoot, came back and carried on as commissioner.
I was uneasy. My fear was the inquiry could turn out to be more polarising than uniting.
I think that he was nervous about the idea of an inquiry, and so there was a fair degree, I think, of suspicion, reserve.
The Home Secretary has ordered a fresh inquiry into the murder of Stephen Lawrence.
The new inquiry into the murder of black teenager Stephen Lawrence will make a further attempt to find out the truth.
when it was announced. I wouldn't describe it as a shockwave through policing, but it was a tremor. It's a warning tremor of the volcanic tectonic plate shifts that were about to occur.
The inquiry to be headed by Sir William McPherson, a former High Court judge.
When it became apparent that it was Sir William McPherson, there was a sigh of relief because Sir William was a distinguished soldier of Special Forces. That seemed okay.
Daxtrell sort of gave on the one hand and took away with the other. It wasn't that there was anything Machiavellian about it, but this was a huge step for society and the black community. To have that chair for that topic seemed completely wrong to us.
Ideally, I think both the family and myself would have wanted a judge who had at least some empathy with black community.
I'm against television in the courtroom because I think it's distracting.
William McPherson responded to Neville and Dorian's reservations about him, I think, with some bemusement.
I can simply hope, again, I have to use that word, that the black community will have confidence in me. I think, in all fairness, everybody must wait to see.
He's more or less like, watch this space, you know, don't judge him by what he's judging by the end. And he definitely will be judged.
The Stephen Lawrence case couldn't be seen in isolation. You had a context of a much wider general suspicion from the black community towards the police. It became, in a sense, totemic of all that suspicion and mistrust and downright hostility that there was from the black community towards the police, and many would say vice versa.
The atmosphere within the inquiry was of a criminal trial, with the police officers being the accused.
The first of the identified issues, this is principally concerned with first aid given or not given at the scene. Did you have a first aid kit in the police car?
To the best of my knowledge, yes.
Was it taken out of the car that night?
No.
It is fair to say, is it not, that no one, while you were there, tried to identify the wound?
Not that I saw.
No police officer?
Not that I saw, no.
That was the information that first came out, hit over the head with an iron bar.
You appreciated the seriousness of the stab wounds only really at the hospital, is that right?
That is when I realised he'd been stabbed, yes.
We don't know if they could have saved him, but the mere fact that they didn't even try, they did nothing to help him, then you begin to think, what sort of people are they?
Today, Inspector Stephen Groves, the man in charge of the initial inquiries, arrived to give evidence to the public inquiry.
When you went to the scene, Mr. Groves, you did not treat this as a murder inquiry, did you?
I thought that what we were dealing with here was possibly a fight.
A fight? This is one of your assumptions, because it was a black victim, was it not?
No, sir. You're accusing me of being a racist now, and that's not true.
I don't think they believed what they didn't believe. That we were just two black boys waiting to get on a bus.
They just ran out and attacked you.
Guess what I'm trying to tell you?
Why would they do that, Dwayne?
I think the officer on the night formed wrongly the opinion this was a drug-related murder. And I think on that basis, and perhaps one or two other examples, branded the whole of the Metropolitan Police as racist. That's a rubbish.
There was no explicit racism. The way this would be discerned is from the pattern of behaviour and how things were explained. In a sense, it was looking at the outcomes. Why are you consistently arresting Dwayne Brooks? Why are you stereotyping him at the scene instead of treating him as a victim? Why don't you arrest suspects for such a long time? Why are you trying to point the finger of blame at the grieving parents?
The relationship with Mr. and Mrs. Lawrence became very difficult.
Unfortunately, yes, it was very, very difficult. There were so many outside agencies from different sort of parties. There seemed to be a lot of barriers put up. We always sort of had to go through Mr. Khan.
Today, by the questioning of Imran Khan, it shows that they're still clearly blaming us for the first investigation. So, I mean, to say, where do we go from here?
Thank you. Thank you very much.
The inquiry was a moment of a reversal of power, and it did feel quite quickly that this was going to be a seminal moment, because very quickly the police evidence started to expose glaring gaps in what they'd done.
It was another grueling day of cross-examination for Detective Inspector Ben Bullock, the second in charge for the majority of the police investigation.
During the course of Saturday the 24th, the investigating team received sufficient information to justify making arrests, had you not?
We had sufficient information to give reasonable grounds, yes, sir.
Photographs, bin bags, removing clothing. By Monday the 26th, you had plenty of evidence to effect an arrest, did you not?
Yes.
The police in the first investigation, they had information within 24 hours. Not only written information, but spoken information about who was responsible. It was not developed and it allowed for the destruction of evidence and all the rest of it.
Why did they delay? Why did they delay?
Detective Superintendent Ian Crampton, who's now retired, said that despite several early tip-offs naming the youths, he felt there wasn't enough evidence to detain anyone.
It's not surprising that the names come up, but it doesn't necessarily mean that whoever wrote that note was an eyewitness. Arresting juveniles on anonymous information is a dodgy old criteria.
The solicitors would have to have been present. First thing I would be asked, what's the evidence against my client? I have to tell him we've got them. You can imagine it being put to me. Didn't you think that if you got them in and merely had to release them, you'd be putting them back into the community for them to threaten people?
But the Met don't arrest anyone until Nelson Mandela comes over it, weeks after Stephen had been murdered.
And then there were extraordinary moments where the police officer agreed that he didn't understand the law on the powers of arrest.
Brian Whedon revealed to the inquiry that he was confused about his powers of arrest. This was astonishing.
Who would imagine someone would stand up and basically say, I didn't know my basic powers of arrest? You couldn't make this stuff up.
Police were pilloried from beginning to end, day after day after day. But we worked just as bloody hard for them as we do for everybody else. So it was doubly disappointing for the first inquiry and for my lot that we weren't able to prove that.
There was great defensiveness by the police. And as I recall, Sir Paul Condon issued a statement complaining about the possibility of police officers being unfairly hauled over the coals.
The police service didn't kill Stephen. It was these racist, despicable thugs who killed Stephen.
A High Court judge has ruled that five men who've all been charged in the past with murdering Stephen Lawrence should give evidence to the inquiry into his death.
The appearance of the five suspects was almost the climax of the inquiry. There was a huge sense of anticipation. It's a public inquiry. Anybody can go up into the public inquiry. And the police were stopping them. Then you have the Nation of Islam downstairs in the foyer. And I remember we were just about to start. Somebody just burst into the room saying that there's commotion happening downstairs. So bad that they had to stop the inquiry. But what the police was doing was totally out of order because the police had used CS gas in their faces and stuff, so it was really, really bad.
Why is it on the Stephen Lawrence inquiry, when it's black people who are coming to seek justice, that the police want to use offensive capability weapons like the CS gas?
This is the scenario that everyone feared. Emotions running out of control down here, and the evidence of the five suspects temporarily derailed.
They were going to cause a riot, and I had to calm them down and tell them that my family don't deal with things like that.
What's happening here this morning is not going to get to the truth.
No.
It's going to stop us getting to the truth. And we are going to be branded as hooligans.
That's right. Yes. Speak, Mr. Lawrence.
It's a public inquiry. You have every right to hear it. But I'm Stephen's mother, and if I ask or request people just to respect me, I think it should be done.
But we can't let them come through and then they just get in a van and go.
Yeah, so what that's the right medicine.
Black people have the right to run their own struggle.
Yes.
And you can't do it through a white judge sitting in some inquiry that doesn't have the opportunity to punish the police that were responsible or to actually put behind bars forever the murderers of Stephen Lawrence.
We'll try to come in now, Jimmy.
If the public needed persuading that this was a case in which, on the one hand, you had Neville and Dorian, and on the other hand, you had these five, Then I think they began to think about the things that had seriously gone awry here. The system that had fallen apart.
One suspect, David Norris, hit out as the youth strutted down the walkway out of the Eltham Castle shopping centre.
That picture fixed in the public mind the fact that there was something really, really badly wrong about this investigation.
A racist crime is one where it just doesn't attack you in the physical sense. There's psychological trauma. There is a sense that there are people out there that hate you, not because they want your phone, but because of your existence as a being. Stephen was murdered simply because he existed, because of the colour of his skin.
At least one of the suspects was hit, but they scrambled into their white getaway van.
This young man, Stephen Lawrence, who's never been in trouble with the police, who's not affiliated with a gang in any way, that is working towards becoming an architect, and you're like, you are protecting these five? Really?
Stephen's come to represent a wound that needs to be healed in our society. It's kind of a weird privilege to come to represent change.
I really think it's best to add nothing to that now.
But is that really...
As the inquiry was going on, you could see McPherson, I think his whole perspective changed while he was listening to Stephen's case.
In an unprompted statement, Sir William spoke for the first time about a crisis of confidence between the black community and the Metropolitan Police.
His unexpected remarks today give the clearest indication so far that his final report will be damning about police racism.
Condon had a very public image, and I think it must have been difficult for him to accept that there was institutional racism on his watch.
We have challenged some of the definitions of institutional racism. I have written to the judge and invited him to give us clarity.
Initially, I think the inquiry heard about 10 or 12 definitions of what institutional racism was and is.
The message has got to be, we are addressing it, we are acknowledging racism, we are addressing it. This is what we've done so far. This is what we're doing even more of.
I'm not sure how we can maintain the current line.
It isn't just about, are you racist, are you not racist? It's much more multi-layered than that.
To try and deflect onto the rest of society will unravel, and that it will sound either grudging or in denial.
What I was not prepared to accept was a definition that meant the police service or individual officers were deliberately being racist as a choice, as a preferred method of operation.
The inquiry chairman, Sir William McPherson, asked the commissioner how he could deal with the problem of racism if he didn't even acknowledge it exists.
Paul Condon offered a personal apology for the failures of his force, but he asked the inquiry not to pronounce the Met guilty of institutional racism.
The commissioner was pushed persistently and pointedly by the inquiry panel to accept there is widespread racism in his police service. Sir Paul repeatedly refused to agree.
I will take those crib notes, John, if I may.
For Condon to say there was a few bad apples, wasn't just a few, was hundreds of them.
I don't see how the Metropolitan Police is going to move on from today. Without admitting to what has been going on, there is no way they can move forward.
I think it would have given Neville and Doreen some comfort if I'd resign, and that weighed heavily on me. But I felt on balance it was my duty and responsibility to lead the service through change.
Me and Neville, we were taken into the Home Office. This is before the report was launched. And Jack Straw said this was a watershed moment for this country. There were just reporters everywhere.
The main message this afternoon is I'm staying and we're changing. Can it go live to Parliament?
There is no doubt that there were fundamental errors. The investigation was marred by a combination of professional incompetence, by institutional racism, and by a failure of leadership.
Perception is king in so many situations, and it's interesting that in the McPherson inquiry, not a single police officer was found to have acted in a racist way.
On the critical issue, institutional racism consists of the collective failure of an organisation to provide an appropriate and professional service to people because of their colour, culture, or ethnic origin.
It confirmed my suspicions that it was a kangaroo court. I know they're wrong. I've been in the Met for 32 years.
It can be seen or detected in processes, attitudes and behaviour which amount to discrimination through unwitting prejudice. And the inquiry found...
It was described by a friend of mine as a necessary humbling of the police. And that was a serving police officer who said that about the Metropolitan Police, a necessary humbling.
It was just amazing. I just think the mere fact that after all these years, we were vindicated, because I think all along people just seemed to be just making noise and causing trouble. It shows that all along we were right.
Some justice. If there's a racist case or anything to do with race, his name is mentioned because of how we pushed. I'm grateful for that.
And I am determined that the legacy of his tragic and brutal death will be enduring reform in the Metropolitan Police Service. Thank you very much.
Would resignation really have been the only honourable course?
No, I don't think so.
So where does the buck stop?
The impact of the McPherson inquiry report was absolutely seismic, because for the black community, I think it brought into stark focus what they had been talking about for years.
In the beginning, it felt like a David and Goliath battle, but by the end, Goliath was a simpering little puppy. Police were reduced to a quivering wreck, and they couldn't come back from where they had been.
Okay, thank you very much.
There is a feeling amongst the public that the established order is not listening, and if it is, it's not responding. And that's actually all that Doreen and Neville were doing. They were putting their finger on the pulse of public conscience. That's why the case has remained apocryphal. It's a watershed. We can all be collectively responsible for making change. That's what she was trying to do. So that's why I think it's gone down in history.
You couldn't really celebrate the report with champagne and caviar. You couldn't really do that because there was unfinished business.
These bastards killed my nephew!
You know, the report happened, the police was questioned, the public was able to hear what's happening, but I didn't have my son. And the killers were still out on the street. That didn't do anything to put them behind bars.
And somehow, somewhere, they're going to pay for what they've done to Stephen.
My name is Clive Driscoll. I was the senior investigating officer into the murder of Mr. Stephen Lawrence.
Whenever I come back, I always feel extremely sad. This was a young man who'd done absolutely nothing wrong. I don't think Stephen would have even remotely understood what was just about to happen to him. And in a very cowardly attack, incredibly cowardly attack, lost his life.
The emotions and trauma 25 years on is still there because of the way that he was butchered, and butchered because he was black.
I've always felt with the family that we'd actually let them down. And I just felt, looking at Stephen, that maybe I might just be able to give them... I can't give them Stephen back, but to give them something, to get some justice for them.
I didn't set out to make a difference. We were pushed into the limelight. I didn't have a choice. The end game was always to get justice and make sure those individuals who murdered my son went to prison.
Teenagers accused of murdering the black schoolboy Stephen Lawrence have been released from custody.
The parents of Stephen Lawrence today failed in their attempt to bring a private prosecution against young men they believed murdered their son.
The inquiry, headed by Sir William McPherson, will look at the way the criminal justice system handles racially motivated crime.
Here was a family who suffered twice. The first time, absolutely devastating to hear that your son has been brutally murdered, as Stephen was. But then to find that the very group of people who you should be able to trust haven't done the job that you'd expected them to do, and you worry about why it is that they haven't done that job.
The McPherson report examines in detail the murder of Stephen Lawrence and its aftermath. It's a chronicle of extraordinary incompetence and ineptitude by the Metropolitan Police. More than that, it's a shaming account of what Sir William McPherson refers to as institutionalized racism in the police and, by inference, more generally in our society.
The acknowledgement that that report gave made me at least feel hopeful for our future and the greater good. It was a moment of idealism that I allowed myself to have.
The Stephen Lawrence inquiry has defined my generation of policing. I can't think of a more impactive public inquiry. And if I speak personally, I can't think of a case which has changed the way I think about policing and doing our job well as much as this one.
My lords and members of the House of Commons, the report into the murder of Stephen Lawrence raised profound issues for our multiracial society. A bill will be introduced which will make it unlawful for public bodies to racially discriminate.
Even though that was a good thing, my son's killers are still walking the street. That didn't do anything to put them behind bars.
My name is Mark Daly, a BBC journalist, and I've been associated with the Stephen Lawrence case for 15 years. After the Daily Mail front page, after McPherson, the world knew, or thought they knew, who was responsible for the murder of Stephen Lawrence. And I guess that must have been partly what drove them to agree to appear on national television.
Tonight, exclusive interviews with the murder suspects in the Stephen Lawrence case.
We're seeing in the public eye as murderers, big-time gangsters, just killers. We're looked upon as scum.
You didn't threaten a woman with a lump of wood. You didn't attack Sean Kalitzi with a cosh. You didn't own the monkey wrench. I mean, come on. Those are three separate incidents of your period as a schoolboy.
And these are all things that have been twisted to make me look like the bad guy.
Did your friends use knives?
No.
You're absolutely sure?
I'm not sure, no, but in my opinion, they didn't carry knives.
Both Jamie and Neil have told us that they did carry knives
yes.
before the murder of yes, Stephen well, Lawrence.
I didn't know that, Martin, I didn't know that.
Two anonymous notes were found, and your name is at the top of both.
Right.
It says in one of them that you and David Norris are the ringleaders. It says you in particular were definitely seen in the area of the murder. It says that you and your brother, quotes, always carry knives and threaten people. Your group are described as very dangerous. Mm. When did you first hear that there had been a murder?
I think it might have been the next day, on the news, I think.
You said that your brother was in the house when this individual came and informed you that there had been an attack.
As far as I can remember, yes.
Yeah. He says the first he heard of the attack was the following day on television.
It was a extremely brazen move. And they came across poorly.
We've got three different stories here as to what happened. What was going on that night? Why can't you all agree with what was happening?
Because maybe we ain't too 100% sure. It's not, like I say, it was a normal weekday night. It was.
But your stories don't tally.
Well, we don't remember every night what you do exactly, what you do,
but
what
conversations. But that was the most important night of your life.
Now I know that.
I was asked to investigate institutional racism in the police, and the starting point for this project was the Stephen Lawrence case. It was the McPherson report. And would you like to go undercover into the Greater Manchester Police? From that time on, I started to steep myself in the happenings of the Stephen Lawrence murder. To my complete shock, the worst racism we encountered was in the training school. One evening, I was in my room, sharing a beer with my colleague, who was the most racist of all the officers that I encountered.
Stephen Lawrence, Carl. Yes, Larry. What are your thoughts on this?
Isn't it good how good memories don't fade? He fucking deserved it. His mum and dad are a fucking pair of sponges. And they've fucking seen a good opportunity and sponged it for everything they can get their hands on, including their MBE.
I just couldn't believe this, that people. A police officer, someone who was going to be on the beat with powers of arrest, CS spray and handcuffs, held those views. What was he doing in the police?
When I saw the film, I could not believe that these were young recruits coming in and they already had those attitudes of what they're going to do to black people, to Asian people, whatever they're going to do. You know, it was unbelievable.
I was constantly stopped, searched, beaten up, put in a cell, released, stopped, searched, beaten up, put in a cell.
It is not the case that 100% of white Britons in this country are racist. That's not the case. But it only takes a smallish number to be so and to create real problems. And it only takes an even smaller number in positions of power not to want to do anything to create even bigger problems.
What do you think about the boys at Bennett?
They fucking need fucking diplomatic immunity, mate. They have done for this country what others fucking should do. McPherson report. I remember it as if it was yesterday. I'd fucking kick in the bollocks for any white man that was.
What I found was a police force on the surface trying to put its house in order and failing appallingly.
Last year, a Home Office report confirmed that words like coon and nigger were part of police culture. They were used, it said, as a sign of group solidarity.
Believe me, we've got nothing against the older police when they're not causing no trouble whatsoever. It's those little young silly CID men.
I do remember an incident where a female officer said to a lady who was pregnant with a Jamaican father, "How do you feel about having a monkey inside of you?" So I'm not going to sit here and say to you that she was sacked, but I'm not going to say to you everything was right.
Between 1965 and 2000, the police were exempt from the Race Relations Act. The police had impunity to discriminate in the use of their powers. So the Lawrence Inquiry recommendation, the full force of the Race Relations Act should apply to the police service. I mean, that was long overdue.
If a police officer calls a black man a nigger, shouldn't he be dismissed?
No. Indeed not. It, like everything else, why should he be dismissed for calling him a nigger?
Because it's a term of abuse.
That's a matter of opinion.
The police have placed a permanent guard on the memorial to the murdered teenager in Eltham's Wellhall Road to prevent further attacks by racist vandals. There's clearly been embarrassment at the revelation that a security camera above the plaque is in fact a dummy.
McPherson propelled the Met to reinvestigate with vigour, which they did with a £6 million investigation by John Grieve in Operation Athena. And I think they threw everything they had at that investigation.
It was a team that was so driven to try to bring people to justice, who did an extremely thorough and diligent job. We took the case to the CPS, and the decision was made that there was insufficient evidence at that time to prosecute.
We are very aware of who the suspects are, and the suspects are aware of who they are. We're aware of Neville and Dorian's agony, and we're very sorry about it, but there comes a point where a decision has to be made, and we, the Met, have to live with that decision.
We had a meeting with the CPS. Rather than talk to me, they gave me a letter for me to read in this meeting. And the letter was trying to tell me that they've looked at the case and there's nothing more that could happen around Stephen's case.
It's understood Mrs. Lawrence walked out of the meeting in disgust, with her lawyer later issuing a statement on her behalf.
The failure of the police to properly investigate in 1993 has directly led us to the position we are in today. Although the decision is not in my favour, I will not abandon the fight for justice in my son's name.
This was clearly a huge disappointment to them. I can't put myself in their shoes, but it was very hard when the decision came from the Crown Prosecution Service.
It takes huge courage for an individual to continue, to keep going, to say, despite all the rebuffs, no, there's something here, we've got to get to the bottom of it. Doreen is a woman of immense integrity and I think hugely inspirational to others because of the way that she carried on. After all that had happened, Neville and I were divorced. Neville was angry with me because I think he wanted the marriage to look on the outside is fine. But for me, that would be a lie. I just couldn't live like that anymore. And I didn't want to.
Being back in Jamaica here has helped me a lot. I don't concentrate on the tragedy as much as when I'm there. At one stage, I couldn't drive down the road where it happened. There were so many reminders about the racist murder of Stephen. I can picture Stephen lying on that ground there. It's painful. I wasn't there to help him.
The most far-reaching change to criminal law for nearly 800 years could soon be brought in. It's the scrapping of the double jeopardy rule that means a suspect can't be tried for the same crime twice.
It was Sir William McPherson's report into the Stephen Lawrence inquiry which first recommended scrapping the double jeopardy rule, which prevents the three men acquitted by a judge at the Old Bailey from ever standing trial again. Today's report by the Law Commission says that in such cases, a retrial should be possible, but only if there is reliable and compelling new evidence.
Not being tried twice for the same offence is a fundamental element of rights in any kind of civilised society. But there will be some circumstances in which the double jeopardy rule causes injustice, and those circumstances are where evidence becomes available at a later date, which either was not or could not have been available at the date of the original trial.
I think when the double jeopardy law was changed, I didn't think it would really help us because of lack of evidence.
The police had failed at that point, and there were a few journalists who were prepared to have a bash, and that's what we did. We gave it a bash. When I was going door to door in Eltham chasing various leads, I met some extraordinarily brave people and I met some extraordinarily scared people. And despite it being 12, 13 years since the murder, it was still very, very raw. And somehow there was still a sense of fear within Eltham, fear of retribution, fear of speaking out against these men, because they still had a reputation for violence. They had a reputation for retribution.
The police said that witnesses lived in fear of your family, mm-hmm. and officers were aware, police officers were aware of threats coming from Clifford Norris, which were discouraging witnesses.
When I'd like to know where the proof of that is, mate.
Clifford Norris was a high-level drug dealer. Clifford had a fearsome reputation. He once shot a woman in the throat because she told tales about him.
David Norris is a suspect in the murder. Clifford Norris is the father. David Norris is not arrested for 2 weeks. He's not even at home when the police go round.
In every investigation, you will find elements of incompetence. But I think in this one, there was so much that was overlooked, which was part of the argument I put forward to McPherson for collusion.
I think it's right to say, had that run smoothly, as you'd have expected, I think arrests would have been made quicker. The McPherson inquiry is very critical of the first 14 days.
It became more difficult to believe that this had been incompetence. I started to think there's something bigger going on here.
As the police authority for London, and also as Home Secretary, I was the final court of appeal for police discipline cases. And that meant that I had a window on the actuality of police corruption. And there were some staggeringly corrupt police officers around at that stage. Corruption inside the Metropolitan Police Service and quite a number of other big police services had been endemic in parts of their CIDs.
The death of Stephen Lawrence and the failure of the Metropolitan Police to bring anyone to justice for it was one of the most scandalous events in recent criminal history. The young men who were the chief suspects in the case remain at large, and tomorrow a BBC documentary will not only disclose what's become of them, but also why, perhaps, the police investigation was so inadequate.
It was when I met Neil Putnam that our investigation took a slightly different turn, and we started to go after the corruption allegations with vigour. In 1994, a year after Stephen Lawrence's murder, Neil Putnam was assigned to the Southeast Regional Crime Squad. On arriving, he says he became embroiled in a world of corruption with a number of officers, which included John Davidson. Now, John Davidson was an integral part of Operation Fishpool, the first investigation into the murder. He was seconded onto it within 36 hours of Stephen being killed.
This interview has been tape recorded. I am Detective Sergeant Davidson. I am interviewing Gary George Dobson.
Now, within a very short time, they had become embroiled in a number of different corrupt jobs, which came to the attention of CIB3, the anti-corruption unit, and Putnam was arrested. Almost immediately, Putnam rolled over and became an informant. And he would be at the centre of a huge anti-corruption operation, which involved him giving evidence against half a dozen officers, and a number of whom would go on to be convicted on the back of Neil Putnam's evidence. By the time I saw him, he had been released from prison. He was happy to speak to me, and he was able to put more flesh on the bones about what he thought went on, and what he thought went on in the Lawrence case was corruption. He thought the Stephen Lawrence investigation had been hampered by a corrupt detective. That corrupt detective was John Davidson.
Davidson told me he was looking after Norris. That to me meant that he was protecting him. He was protecting his family against arrests and any conviction.
So you're telling me that a key detective in the first Lawrence investigation was corrupt and in the pocket of Clifford Norris, the father of one of the suspects?
John Davidson told me, looking after Clifford Norris, he was having a nice little earner out of it. And by a nice little earner, I knew from my years in the police service, and especially on the corrupt side of it, a nice little earner meant you were receiving corrupt payment.
We've always suspected stuff about Davidson. He was somebody I didn't trust back in the day. And then the rumours about him and the Norris family. Corruption was part of the big thing for us within the inquiry, but nothing came of it.
John Davidson denied any wrongdoing, and the Independent Police Complaints Commission launched an investigation, which, after a year or so, concluded that there were no grounds for the allegations the BBC had made. Basically, the IPCC said that the BBC had got it wrong. that the journalism had been sensationalist and irresponsible.
With my mother, I used to watch a gentleman called George Dixon, Dixon the Doc Green, and I've always felt that that particular programme portrayed the police as very dependable, very reliable, someone who actually wanted to help members of the public in a fair and balanced way.
All correct, George. Good.
I always felt that that's what I'd like to be. I had from an incredibly early age, I wanted to be a police officer because of what I thought the police were and should be, and I wanted to be part of that, really.
My first impression of Clive is just that he's another police officer that I have to deal with. I don't have to like you. Whatever it is that you're doing, it's your job. You just need to get on with it.
He came across as an incredibly strange individual who referred to you as sir and ma'am. He was so old-fashioned in his approach that I thought he was a throwback to the bad old days. And I was wrong.
One, two. Here, we've got a decision to make today. I can either be Dick Van Dyke, if you want me to be. There we go. As I live and breathe, Mary Poppins. Or my personal favourite, Sherlock. Sherlock it is. We'd sold Deptford Police Station to a developer, and I was asked to go over to make sure that there was nothing left in that police station that could embarrass the Metropolitan Police Service. And when I went over there, there was a room with probably hundreds of boxes, Operation Fishpool, which is actually the murder of Stephen Lawrence. And I remember saying, well, what are we going to do with all of these boxes?
Will I be handsome? Will I be rich?
And I remember at the time, the superintendent, he said, bin them. And I said, well, someone's got to deal with them. And eventually I spoke to the now commissioner, but then commander, Dick, Crested to Dick, and said to her, well, I will take that on. And so I took over Stephen on the 20th of June, 2006.
Well, maybe it's because I'm a Londoner that I love London so.
He seemed thoroughly determined to do what he could on this case, and I think one of the things that Clive Driscoll was very good at is winning your trust. And he won the trust of a lot of people, and he had to.
Maybe it's because I'm a Londoner that I love London town.
Cressida Dick told me to watch a presentation that had been prepared by the Racial and Violent Crime Task Force. And someone had spent an awful lot of time putting together where the witnesses were. It was like a pathway to what had happened on the night in April 1993, there was a part of the presentation which said that Mrs. Lawrence had said we couldn't see Stephen's school records. Well, Jim Mould, who was my old DI, best bit of advice anyone's ever given me was, yeah, listen, Clive, but read all the statements. That's what evidence is. That's what the court get. You know, that's what people base cross-examinations on. So read the statements. And I think it was about the third statement I read was Mrs. Lawrence giving us permission to see the school records.
Everything they've asked me for, I've always given. I've never held anything back from the police.
These are school photos.
I didn't even remember about the school record because I know had they asked me, it would have been yes.
They said, you know, you've got to be careful because she might be critical of you. And I remember saying, well, she's got every right. She's mum. She lost her son, for God's sake, you know. So at that point, I thought, well, if I can't rely on what I've been told, then I've got to double-check everything. I used to go down Wellow Road and I used to read the statement and I'd walk the same way that witness may have walked, or I would walk around the houses where that witness may have walked. Certainly one of the most useful things was when I walked with Mr. Brooks. He was there, wasn't he?
One day I met Clive and we were speaking about the scene and I was describing the scene to him and I was describing the tree and he was like, Dwayne, what tree? I don't know what you're talking about. I said, what do you mean, Clive? He goes, well, I've been to the scene and I can't see this tree. What do you mean, Clive? I was confused. So I said, the best thing is that we go down there together so I can describe it all to you. So when I go to the scene now, I can see all the changes that have been made. So I point out to him how the road was, because the road how it is today isn't how it was in 1993. The junction's completely different. And so where the tree would be and where the layout of the road would be is completely different. So I pointed that all out to him and then said, Clive, you need to go and look at the pictures that were taken. So he goes back and looks at the pictures, and then that cleared up something important for him, but he didn't tell me what it was.
There's a bus coming. Can you see it coming?
Whilst checking all of the statements together, we found out it wasn't a brief attack or anything like it. It could have been as long as 45 seconds to 50 seconds, but if you're getting whacked, 50 seconds is a very long time. And when I lecture, I will do what barristers do. You'll hate me for it. I'll stop talking for 50 seconds. I won't, but 50 seconds is quite a length of time, actually. A brief attack would be 5 seconds, whack on the nose and away. That revelation really probably was the catalyst for us solving the entire case.
Myself, Clive, and our exhibits officer went down to LGC of forensics, and sat round the table were the heads of the disciplines of forensic science, so someone from hairs, someone from DNA, someone from fibres. They'd all been supplied the statements, they'd all had a look at stuff. But when you're reading stuff dry from many years ago, the statements aren't written like a novel. They're not written to be exciting. They're written to be very factual. And when we finished the meeting and discussed what we were, you know, how we would go forward, Clive and I had a bit of a discussion around, well, what can we do to actually liven up the room?
I decided that I had to recreate the attack so exact that I went out and trawled the Metropolitan Police Service and found a young man. He was the same weight, he was the same height, and bless his heart, he's a hero. We reenacted it over about 2.5 to 3 hours, every possible conceivable way that attack could have happened. And then we went back to LGC Forensics, because they had been told it's a brief attack, almost to say, look, ignore that. Ignore it. It's not safe. It is unsafe. And this is the reason why. And we bored them senseless with thousands of slides of all these different attacks, but emphasising all the time it could be between 25 and 50 seconds.
I'm Angela Gallup, and I was the... I am a forensic scientist, but I was involved in managing the project and making sure that we had the right group of scientists working on it.
I have to say that Angela Gallup straight away went, wow, oh, well, you know, this is, oh, look. And I have to say, from that moment on, they had a far wider view of what they should be doing.
The attack group were out that night looking for another group to attack. They see Stephen and Dwayne, and then they rush across the road, mount the attack. We know from witnesses that there was muffled shouts, there was noises being heard, so we know it wasn't silent. If that's the case, then during shouts, saliva would emanate from the suspect's mouth and end up on Stephen's clothing. That was our number one thought around what we can do that hasn't been done before.
I remember thinking in 1995 that we'd had a good look at the case, little realising the strides we would take in finding traces to test. The whole way of dealing with samples, it has meant that information can be got from smaller samples, and it's more discriminating, so it can give you more information about where it came from.
What was different? We asked them to do tests that would be exactly the same as if it happened that day.
We were very interested in the list of items that the police had collected from around the scene. And one of these things was a length of scaffolding pole. And we discovered on this pole that there was some paint marks, as there very often is on scaffolding. And so we were very interested to see whether we could find traces of this paint on Stephen's clothing. And while we were looking for paint, we started to notice some textile fibres.
Stephen Lawrence was wearing five layers of clothing. He had a vest, he had a polo shirt, he had a jumper, he had a body warmer, and he had a jacket. They then started to look, well, where did these fibres come from? And they worked out that what had happened was it came from Stephen's red polo shirt.
I invented the word sheddability, because there isn't such a word, but I called it sheddability because Stephen's clothing was made up in such a way that it lost a lot of fibres. So Stephen's, if you like, third layer of clothing was everywhere. So if it's going everywhere, it had to be on the outside of his clothing, which means if it's on the outside of his clothing, the opportunities for it going on someone else's clothing is very high.
That's the first breakthrough that was found.
Within 3 weeks, the scientist phoned me up and said, do you know what? I found all these red fibres. Thousands of them.
We had found two different kinds of red fibres on one of the suspects. It was Gary Dobson, on an item of his clothing.
I put it to you that you were one of the five responsible for Stephen Lawrence's murder.
But that's your opinion.
I put it to you that you were one of the five. Did you kill Stephen Lawrence?
No, I did not.
If these fibres had come from Stephen, this was evidence going in the other direction, going from Stephen's clothing to the suspect's clothing. Then we should be looking at other items of Stephen's clothing as potential sources of fibres on the suspect's clothing. And so we then just widened our search to include, for example, his trousers. Stephen's trousers were a sort of green-coloured elephant cord, which shed its constituent fibres very readily. And we found some of these fibres on an item of David Norris's clothing.
I suggest to you that your memory lapse was really because you knew you were guilty.
Mm-hmm.
That was why you didn't say anything.
That's fair enough. You're entitled to your opinion. And 99% of this country, in my opinion, believe the same thing, Martin.
Well, what alternative
as long as I know
got
in my heart the truth, that's all that counts, in my opinion. That's all that counts for me.
When they were shining the light on these fibres, one of the scientists noticed that there has been blood on this fibre, but over the years it has fallen off, but it's left some of its invisible properties behind on the fibre. But where's the blood?
Well, we've looked at the surface debris taken from the suspect's clothing, but shall we go back and have a look in the bags, the original packaging in which the clothing had been sealed? And so we started collecting the debris from inside the original packaging. And we found another, at least one more fibre of interest doing that. But much more importantly, we found a fragment of Stephen's blood. And running through the fragment of blood, encased in it, were two other fibres, both of the same type. And so now we've got this fragment of Stephen's blood in the packaging, and we, you know, it can't just have turned up there on its own.
I was actually at the 15th anniversary of Stephen's death at St Martin's in the Field. All the King's horses and all the King's men. There was David Cameron. There was Mrs Smith, the Home Secretary. There was Brown, who was the Prime Minister. I was sitting right behind him. He'd probably never forgive me for the way I sang into his ear. So there was this whole group of people, very influential people, and I remember Peter Birdsall, Birdie, he said, Governor, you've got to phone Ed Jarman, who is the most wonderful scientist, really, Mr Jarman. So there was a free kick wall of dignitaries, you know, having their photograph taken with Baroness Lawrence. And there was a massive poster of young Stephen. And I was looking, literally looking straight at him when I spoke to Ed Jarman, who said to me that they'd found Stephen's blood on Gary Dobson's jacket. And I did think to myself, well, Steve, mate, it ain't gonna be long now, because I did. Because that's what I thought, you know, it ain't going to be long. And I remember going out and speaking to Cressida Dick, who's now a commissioner, and I'm sure she'd hate me for saying this, but she's quite petite. And I leant down and in her ear and whispered that, and she said, "Oh gosh." It's like one of those magical moments, isn't it? Gosh. And this was the one time I thought, do you know what? We could give the family something.
I had my suspicions, because we've been told so many things. And it's like, I won't believe anything until it happens. You know, and I suppose I didn't want to get my hopes up. And I didn't want to allow myself to be in that position, because I allowed myself to be in that position before.
I'm Alison Saunders. I'm the director of public prosecutions, and I was the reviewing lawyer in the prosecution of Gary Dobson and David Norris. This was such an iconic case. If there was to be any subsequent prosecution, we had to make sure that this was really something that we had gone into in as much detail as we could, covered every angle that we could, and that we would get it right. We sat down with the scientists and sort of went through all the theories about why was it missed before, why was it there now, could it have got there by other means? So I suppose we were thinking, is this really too good to be true? Can it stand up in court?
What I didn't want to do was another disappointment for the family. Well, I would never forgive myself for it. So it was about making sure we dotted the I's, crossed the T's every time, five times, 10 times, but making sure we really drilled into that evidence to ensure that it was safe, not only for the family, but for the court, for defence, for prosecution, for the Crown Prosecution Service.
We met with Mrs. Lawrence and Mr. Lawrence, with their legal representatives as well. We couldn't tell them the detail, because what we didn't want to do is we wanted to be realistic and we wanted to sort of keep them informed, but at the same time, we didn't want to give them too much information and a false hope. So it was quite a delicate balance.
Clive was telling me, I'm about to do something and I just wanted to let you know. And so I didn't know which of the individuals that was going to be arrested at the time. So I think it gives you information, but it doesn't always tell you every single thing.
We knew where Mr. Dobson was, because Mr. Dobson had been convicted of a drugs conviction. I think he got 3.5 years for it. He was actually serving a prison sentence in Belmarsh. We arrested Gary Dobson. We knew David Norris was in a pub in southeast London. And David Norris, I think, is someone who knows how to speak to police, because he was chatting like somehow we were mates. But I'm not your mate. I think he probably thought, like Mr. Dobson thought, oh, here we go. Here we go again. You know, same old, same old. But, you know, it was different, wasn't it?
I would like you to tell me how Stephen Lawrence's hair is on the jeans seized from your bedroom.
No comment.
Is there an innocent explanation for how this hair has appeared on those jeans?
No comment.
Trial of the year, trial of the decades, trial of the century. They had to have a breakout room for the media. And if you wanted to get into the courtroom, you had to be there early.
My name is Alison Morgan, and I was junior counsel for the prosecution. By the time we were at trial, of course, Mr. Dobson had been joined in the dock by Mr. Norris, so it was a joint trial. The gang always came as a group, but we were very much inclined that what this should be was a cold, hard forensic look at what the evidence was capable of demonstrating. So although we knew that what the family would want was for all of those people that they had suspected of being involved in the offence to be put on trial, we had to be objective, we had to be impartial about it and look at what the evidence demonstrated.
Considering that they were 16, 17 when they committed the crime, and these guys would have been in what, their 30s now, early 30s, they looked really old.
The enduring image of David Norris I have in my head is the still taken at the McPherson inquiry. The snarling, teeth-bared, angry face that he had. That was not the image that was presented in court. Gone entirely was the swagger he and Dobson had portrayed. They were diminished, for sure. But still, they gave evidence in their own defence. Maybe somewhere they thought that's all it would take if they were to stand up and answer questions.
The defence attacked the forensic because that was the new and compelling evidence, either that it must be somehow contaminated over the years that it had been kept, or that it was sort of somehow it wasn't direct transmission, because particularly the blood on Dobson's jacket was in a really strange place.
When you stab someone, your hand is on the one hand involved with stabbing and on the other hand is withdrawing the knife. And what you can get is blood going down the back of someone's clothing. So finding a small spot inside the back of the neck of an assailant's clothing is not at all surprising.
A key moment in the trial was when the judge decided that the prosecution could show the famous surveillance tape.
I'll take one of them. It's skin and black alive. Torture and set him alive. I'll be testing himself when he kills himself. I'll throw their two legs and arms on the same one.
Once we got to the point where we'd established the scientific evidence, we'd established the continuity of the exhibits, and we demonstrated who those defendants really were in 1994, when they were 16, 17, 18 years old, it was very difficult for them to then go into the witness box and re-establish their credibility as people who would never have been involved in an attack of this nature.
Given evidence at the Old Bailey was very emotional, I could see for other people in the court and the jury members, it was quite upsetting when I explained how it all wasn't in great detail.
Even though you know what had happened to Stephen, and having to sit and listen to it again about some of his wounds that he had, I think I probably shut down in some of the cases I didn't want to hear. But at the same time, I didn't want to leave the room. I didn't want to walk out of the room. Having the press so close, you just couldn't, at least I felt I couldn't show any emotions. Even when I was getting really angry and anxious, I couldn't show that.
During the trial, both defendants called their mothers to try and establish their alibi at the relevant time.
Although she couldn't remember a year ago,
yes,
she actually can remember now.
Yes, because I asked her the same question and she said to me, she's been trying and trying and trying for so many years to think, and the only possible explanation she could think is that I was round McGilvin's, and that's where I think I was.
Gary Dobson says that he was round the A courts, as I remember. The reason he was round there, he was taking a CD back to them, and the CD was a Bob Marley CD. He was basically saying, you know, I'm not racist because I listen to reggae music.
I remember thinking, when I heard the full extent of the prosecution case, is that it? And I guess there was a worry that it was, in some regards, maybe a bit thin.
You just set about to do the best job that you can do with the evidence that you have, present that as well as you can, and that's really all that you can do.
Good afternoon and welcome to the BBC News at One. Almost 19 years after Stephen Lawrence was stabbed to death in South London, two men have finally been jailed for his murder. In front of a packed courtroom, Gary Dobson was sentenced to at least 15 years in jail and David Norris to at least 14 years behind bars.
When the verdict came through, not just in the Met, but in police stations around the country, people told me there was cheering. You know, people saw that as a great moment.
Even when it was announced that they were guilty, you know, inside of you, you wanted to shout out, say, like, yes, you know, at long last. But I felt like I was restricted in how I can behave.
Despite these verdicts, today is not a cause for celebration. How can I celebrate when my son lies buried?
I think for the first time in years, there was a smile on my face. At last, some kind of redress about the fact that these racists had killed somebody and been boasting for years and living their own life, having kids.
After the defendants had left the dock, DCI Driscoll was brought up into the witness box.
I thought I was going to get told off, actually. I thought, cool, what have I done here? And I went up in the box and he gave me a judge's commendation, which I, and the team, a judge's commendation. He said some very kind words about what we'd done. But he did say those immortal words, which I suppose I'll paraphrase him. Well, OK, don't rest on your laurels. There's some more out there. Go and get them.
Through his work, we've got two. And there's all the other individuals still to be charged. And I believed at the time that we probably would get, I don't know, one or two others, I don't know. But I believe that we probably would with Clive in charge.
The following day, Mr. Lawrence's legal representative come up to me and said, did you celebrate last night? And I said, no, we went and had a quiet Indian curry, to which she said to him, all worse, did you do that to show you're not racist? And I said, yeah, we put on a Bob Marley record as well.
If it hadn't been for Clive, we still would have been here today talking about the same where Stephen's killers are walking the streets.
The other people involved in the murder of Stephen Lawrence should not rest easily in their beds. We are still investigating this case. And I'd just like to take this opportunity, if anybody out there has any more information or any evidence, even after all this time, please tell us.
Clive Driscoll, along with his team, secured convictions in the longest-running murder saga, most damaging episode in the Met's history. Clive Driscoll turned that around and got those convictions. He would have thought that he would have been lauded within the Met and given whatever he wanted to continue investigating this case. That didn't happen.
The following day, I had one phone call where it was suggested that we'd done enough. In fact, that all the inquiries had been done and everything, you know, been finalised on Stephen, which I disagreed with.
Once the trial was over, the message I was getting from Clive was completely different.
Why wouldn't the Met want to pursue that? Why wouldn't they want to carry on? Why wouldn't they have wanted to support Clive Driscoll? Questions only a few people in the Met can answer.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Olympic flag.
The flag is carried by Doreen Lawrence. We salute her tireless thirst for justice.
Hearing the crowds, how they were cheering when they heard my name. Sorry. It's walking out, holding it. I think some of the things that's happened, I say, like, if my grandmother could see me now. And that's one of those things.
After the two suspects are convicted for the murders, and you think that's the end of the Lawrence story, surely more material would come out, new themes would emerge.
I think the most important thing was for us to continue to see Theresa May, which we did, Imran, myself and the Lawrences, because we were saying on their behalf that their belief there was collusion and corruption has not dissipated, and that we wanted investigated. We want another inquiry. Well, in the end, Home Secretary appointed Mark Ellison to see if there was anything in the materials we were giving them. And of course, there was. Only it's much bigger than Lawrence.
I'd asked Mark Ellison to look at the question of potential police corruption, whether any allegations had been looked into and had been properly reported to the McPherson report.
Ellison said that based on Neil Putnam's testimony, there was reasonable cause to suspect that John Davidson was corrupt.
During the course of the review, it became obvious that there had been a significant failing in understanding how these corruption issues might have impacted on the investigation. What we never got to was a smoking gun demonstrating exactly how. As time went on, it became harder and harder to know whether we could reach any definite conclusions as to the facts, given the absences in the records. And that also raised question marks about whether or not the absences in the records were part of some deliberate absence because the records had been disposed of. There was something more to all of this than perhaps had been thought previously.
Once Mark Ellison had started his work, an individual came forward and said that he had been required as an undercover officer to go into one of the groups that was alongside the Lawrence family.
Peter Francis, old alias Pete Black, the man whose account earlier this year of life undercover proved politically explosive.
I was asked, could I find out anything that could be used to maybe get the public to not have as much sympathy for the Stephen Lawrence campaign as in what it truly had.
It was as a result of that that our terms of reference were broadened to look at undercover policing. Whilst it was clear that Peter Francis had got close to the Lawrence campaign, the Metropolitan Police denied that there had been any tasking to undermine the campaign. And records just simply didn't exist for us to reach a conclusion one way or another. The police had in mind a wider public interest, but the reality was that they were spying on victims of crime.
The report was profoundly shocking. Allegations of corruption in the Metropolitan Police. He said they'd been inadequately investigated. McPherson report, it was supposed to have been able to look at everything. It couldn't because the information wasn't given to it. And a real concern about undercover policing and that undercover police had been able to give the Metropolitan Police information about the family and how they were approaching the inquiry.
Whenever you start talking about this case, some of the things that these people do is unforgivable and not in line in finding justice for us.
Given the gravity of what has now been uncovered, I have decided that a public inquiry led by a judge is necessary to investigate undercover policing and the operation of the SDS. There was a concern that in some quarters there were perhaps police officers who in some sense felt they were above the law and that in a sense they didn't have to operate to the same sort of rules as everybody else. And being a police officer is a hugely important job and people need to have confidence in the police. And talking to Doreen, it was quite obvious that that confidence had gone. She had no confidence in what they'd done.
We as a family had to go through all this and still there's more to come out.
I don't think we'd ever get to the bottom of corruption. The justice system would never allow those things to be investigated in a way in which you could get to the truth.
The Met is a completely different organisation from the one it was when Stephen was killed. You know, if somebody suggests to me that I have corruption in my organisation or I have a corrupt person, you know, I will go after that as hard as I can. I think we are infinitely more open now than we were when I joined, and the reason, in large part, why we are so much better is because of the Stephen Lawrence inquiry.
I think that the Stephen Lawrence case did move things forward. I think we have seen changes of attitude in the police, but I think there is still more for us to do.
The police are not a learning organisation, so the things that happened years ago will continue to happen. And we're seeing that today. There is a knife crime epidemic. and there doesn't seem to be the will to tackle it. I feel that we've taken huge steps in some respects, and in others, pigeon steps. But we needed some form of justice to show that it can be done.
Doreen's struggle for justice did not just help the black community, it helped all communities. It made policing better for not just the black communities, but for everybody.
If you look at what it's done to Baroness Lawrence and Neville Lawrence and Mr. Brooks, if you look what it's done to the Metropolitan Police Service, there's been a lot of casualties. The most awful casualty is Stephen Lawrence.
What's amazing is the legacy that he has left behind. He's a part of our nation's history. There's the England before Stephen, and there's the England after Stephen.
Because of my religious background, I have forgiven them for what they've done. These racists who killed my son, because I couldn't go on with the rest of my life feeling anger about something which has destroyed my way of living, has destroyed my marriage, and caused me not to be able to live where my kids and grandkids are. So I had to forgive them.
Doreen had borne the brunt of this campaign to bring our son's killer to justice. And we know there was at least five boys who were part of the gang of boys who killed Stephen. Two have been convicted. And I wondered whether that would be enough for Doreen to let her just try and get on with her life.
I always think a lot of positive things have come out of it. But still, if I could change it, I'd give anything just to be back to where we were back in 93, before he died. I don't think any of these things really... So, I don't think any of these things really matters. I think for what I've lost, it doesn't matter. Let me stop that.